Preparing a live stream.
I think we're good.
All right, we are now streaming. So welcome everyone to the premiere episode of the Listening Lab. I am B.
And I am W.
I think we're good.
And this is the Listening
Lab. Listening Lab.
So Weston, why don't you start us off real
welcome
quick?
Welcome everyone.
I think we've got somebody on.
Of the Listening Lab. I am B.
I am W.
I think we're good. This is the Listening Lab.
What's happening right now?
This is amazing. So Weston, I know what's going on.
Welcome, everyone. I think we've got some here episode. Listening Lab. I am
B. I'm trying to figure out how to do that, Weston.
This is the Listening Lab.
This is so good. It's like on a repeat or something. It's crazy. Were you able to mute the YouTube?
I just closed. Are we still live? Yeah.
Yeah. Live. Yeah.
I'll clean that up.
That's fantastic.
Send the link to everybody. Yes. All right, so we're definitely going to have to clean that little bit up, but
absolutely,
it's not worries. Let's just start over again, okay? And I will cut all this stuff off.
Sounds good.
Everyone, welcome to our premiere episode. Oh, good. Don't worry, guys. We're going to clean this up. Hey everyone, welcome to the premiere episode of the Listening Lab. I'm B.
And I'm W.
And this is
the Listening Lab.
So this is something that Weston and I kind of came up with in the past week or two. You know, with the lockdown and everything going on. I just thought, well, you know, why don't I just readdress some technical things that, you know, quite frankly, we should always be doing, checking in, you know, just with ourselves, if not our teachers. It's hard when we're on the road, but, I had read parts of chapters of Great Singers on Great Singing, over, you know, years ago. I know it's kind of, it can be a controversial, book because it can be somewhat confusing because you're going to get a lot of conflicting,
opinions.
Ideas, yeah. And that's fine. But now after doing this for a while, I love like sitting there and hearing what, Luciano or Mirella Freni or Sutherland or Milnes or Corelli or all these things. And, you know, Jerome Hines was a wonderful singer and bass, and the fact that he just had the idea to do this and put all this knowledge together, whether you agree with it or not, whether it's helpful or confusing, you know, there'll be different times, the kind of book that you just read it in different times. You know, one thing might stick out that didn't stick out before, or, you know, we're not going to spend too much time because it goes into great depth about what does somebody do about breathing, placement, larynx position, all these kinds of things, right? This is not really about that. It's more about these wonderful recordings that taught us kind of the way that opera goes. I mean, in New Orleans, I didn't have only but maybe three or four chances to see a live opera a year. But with this magic of this CD that I could put in the 5-disc changer in the back of my Honda Accord, I could listen to all kinds of things. And that's really what I did when I was in college, driving around New Orleans, was just listen to these. You know, the first one is today, is Rigoletto, and Weston and I have sung those roles a good bit, and we both love this recording. We're not by any means saying this is the best one. It's just one that we both spent a lot of time listening to. For me, obviously, Pavarotti was it was the three tenors that brought me to opera in general. And Weston was telling me a story earlier about how when he got his first role at 18 or so, he went to the CD store and bought it.
Right, right. Yeah. So, you know, when you're a young student and you get cast in an opera and you're unfamiliar with the art form, I think that, you know, these historic recordings are incredible devices that allow us to hear, like you said, like how it goes. What does it sound like, you know? And of course, at 18, I didn't realize that there were like 55, you know, different recordings of Le Nozze di Figaro. But I was cast in the title role of Figaro, and I was trying to figure out how am I going to navigate my way through this score. And so, you know, back in the day, I picked up that Levine recording, the Metropolitan Opera Orchestra with Don Upshaw singing Susanna, Thomas Hampson was the Count, you know, and God, I wore that thing out. You know, that's how I first had my introduction to that piece. And, you know, tonight we're going to talk about the Decca label recording of Rigoletto by Giuseppe Verdi with Luciano Pavarotti singing the Duke, Joan Sutherland singing Gilda, and Cheryl Milnes singing Rigoletto, which is definitely a recording I became aware of in graduate school for a number of reasons, which we'll get to later in the show. But, you know, it's, I think in many ways, you know, definitive of a generation of singers, because those guys at this point were in their prime. I mean, when was this recording made?
71.
Okay. 71. And so how old were the, what age was Pavarotti and Sutherland?
I'm glad that you asked that question, because I did a little bit of research, which is what we're going to do, right? We're going to do just basic things. I mean, I'm not by any means a music history major or any of those kinds of things, but this is mainly from Wikipedia, a little bit from Great Singers on Great Singing, maybe The Four Voices of Man, and other interviews and master classes of things that are on YouTube.
Sure.
So Luciano and Cheryl Milnes were both 36, right? So young, quite frankly.
Yeah.
I expected they just, you know, they sound fresh. I don't know. 36 is kind of young. At 41, I'm like, damn, 5 years ago.
Huh? I know. Well, at 45, I'm like, 10 years ago, nine years ago.
Yeah, Sutherland was 45. Yeah. She was older than them, right? So she was obviously, but she was born in 26. And these guys were both born in 35. And then Bonning, who was her husband, or who is, well, was her husband and is the conductor on this, was born in 1930, so that puts him right at 41.
Wow.
So we're going to do, like I said, we're going to give a little bit of background. I know everyone knows who these guys are. And
if you don't, thankfully nowadays, we have things like YouTube and Spotify and Apple Music and everything else. So if there's young students who are watching who might not be familiar with these singers that we're talking about, we cannot encourage you enough to research these people, listen to their, I mean, it's unbelievable the amount of information that you can acquire from just a YouTube rabbit hole evening of, you know, start with, you know, Pavarotti and see where it leads, you know?
Absolutely. And I mean, we used to have to save up for these recordings that cost $50. Now you can go to YouTube for free. You can go to Apple Music for $9.99 and get anything that's on there.
Yeah.
Spotify has an impressive amount of operatic recordings. So, you know.
If you're still looking for those CDs, we looked on eBay the other night and like literally a CD set that used to cost like $55-$60 like that was on sale for $5.
So that's my original one that rode around with me in my Honda Accord for my 4 years of college and thereafter. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so that, and then also it occurred to me because I went to Paris to finish up some recording things that I did because when I was in Torino, we had 9 days of recording, we got 7 good days, and I was just tired the last days, so we had to go to Paris and kind of fix these things up. So in Torino, we did it with the orchestra live on the stage as if it were a concert, let's say. In Paris, we did it over playback. So that meant that I was kind of doing opera karaoke. I had headphones on. I was singing into a mic in a big room, but there was no orchestra. You know, some may consider that cheating. I just considered it, well, I mean, did I need to finish the CD or not? It's certainly not ideal. I can say that everything I sang was my own singing and my own notes. There's, you know, if we think of recording in studio, studio recordings and the producer and the sound engineer, these guys are kind of like the Photoshoppers for studio recordings, right? It doesn't mean that it's not real. It just means that it's touched up or.
Well, and some things are more Photoshopped than others, right?
Well, absolutely. I mean, you know, we're not talking about auto-tune. Auto-tune is not something that's used in classical music or opera. It obviously, you know, distorts the tone so much to where it's no longer viable, but you can do things like splice in you know, do phrase by phrase if someone is sick or whatever. I mean, I know that people have done that. There are famous stories of singers who will remain nameless who just went in and dropped in their high notes because that they didn't get a good high note or they were just too tired. And
story time. I was an undergraduate senior and I had to record Largo al Factotum from the Barber of Seville, which of course ends on these big high G's. Delace, right? I could not make it through that aria in one take. I was so tired. I had no idea what I was doing singing wise. But this company was interested in hiring me. And one of the roles that I would sing on this tour with this company was Figaro in the Barber of Seville.
Right.
So they were like, well, we definitely want you to submit a recording of you singing. You know, back then it was a cassette tape. We definitely want the tape of you singing Largo al Factotum. Thankfully.
Mini disc players, all
those. Oh, I know, right? At least with mini discs, it was able to kind of, you could get the tracks right there. But I was so thankful to the audio engineer at Texas Tech University when I was doing my, at that point, I was finishing up my last year there. And he was able to splice the majority of the aria up until, you know, like, so if I told him, stop. Weston takes a breather for about 5 minutes. I just let it rip. And it was like, when I played it back, I was like, oh my God, this sounds like I sang the whole thing. And lo and behold, I got the gig. And then I had to figure out how to sing it.
Right, exactly. And then this is something that, you know, in this day and age where everything is going virtual and, you know, online things, I know that they're being really picky about things that, because it's got to be video, right? So it's completely obvious if the video cuts and
comes
back. And then if the audio is a little bit off, the sync will be off. But yeah, back in the day, that was absolutely it. And the thing is that, you know, again, some people say this is cheating or why aren't you doing live performances or whatever. And I think we will get to live performances, but really I think we envisioned this as an homage to these legends who taught us how opera goes.
Absolutely.
And we're going to make comments. They're not really criticisms. They're just more observations because I think as singers, and Weston and I, you know, are more technically minded. I think we enjoy thinking about things and talking with each other about these things. I mean, that's the whole reason Under the Hood.
Right. I was just going to say the whole premise of my talk show of Under the Hood, it was sort of based on, you know, the great singers are great singing, but it's sort of a modern day approach to that where we can use this medium of Zoom and being posted to Facebook and YouTube and so forth. So I can understand the way that different singers approach different technical aspects of their performance. And I got to say, it's been such an incredible pleasure to interview people like yourself, Brian. I love the episode that we got to do together. And, you know, just hear a bigger, you know, sort of deeper inside scoop on what's going on in the noggin when we're approaching this stuff.
Right. I mean, there is this kind of taboo about technique.
Yeah.
Because, like, you know, certain teachers are like, well, my way is the only way. And I understand how teachers might be inclined to feel that way. And so, you know, there's the studio wars. This people, they hate those studios.
Right.
Especially at schools, right?
Yeah. I mean,
or in summer programs like Aspen or something. I mean, Weston and I met while we were both studying with Stephen Smith in Aspen in 2003.
Yeah.
And actually, we sang Act
3
of Rigoletto.
Or three. All three. Yeah.
However you want to cut it. From, you know, the last thing on
the orchestral interlude all the way through to the end. Yeah.
Precisely. And so we started off talking about technique because he had been studying with Steve at Juilliard for,
one year. That was in between the 2 years.
And Steve was completely different as far as his technical approach from my first teacher, which is Philip Frohmeyer, who has passed. But he had a very forward, he was a baritone with a very dusky voice. And so he really loved the forward, bright kind of snarl, especially for a tenor. You know, the sound was very penetrating and it cut a lot. But I didn't have the ease of singing that I had seen other people do. And I, you know, so there was a Korean tenor, Jang Won Lee, who I roomed with in Marilla. And he studied with Steve, and I was like, there's something that this guy knows, Jung Won, that I don't know.
One of the nicest people in the world too, right?
Super nice, super nice. Okay. We had such a great time together that summer in San Francisco. So anyway, I wanted to come and learn from his teacher, Steve Smith.
Yeah.
And quite frankly, that caused some problems between me and my first teacher, because they were kind of, you know, competing studios at Aspen for those years in 98, 99, where I went to Aspen and studied with Phil.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's the breaks, unfortunately. We are in charge of our own instrument, our own artistry. And I was so thankful to everything that every voice teacher has ever taught me, quite frankly. But yeah, sometimes you just have to, you know, in order to grow, you have to change. And sometimes those changes can be difficult. But, you know, if it's, you know, if you're trying to just learn something that you don't know, I think nobody can hold that against you.
Right. And sometimes it's two steps forward, you know, two steps forward, one step back. But I mean, you know, the whole idea is to get as much knowledge as we can. And I think that getting back to the premise of this show, there is so much knowledge to be learned from these incredible artists and these unbelievable historic recordings that at least you and I have grown up with.
So. Yeah. And so just in closing, before we actually get to the Rigoletto part, but I thought it was important for us to kind of let people know where, how this organically kind of, you know, formed in our minds, and how, you know, we're not just trying to shamelessly self-promote here. this is really just something that I think younger singers can have and use as a basis of, like, how does one start to listen to these recordings? And then what can you glean from listening to how a masterful singer handles an aria or the whole role or whatever? You know, there are objective and subjective things about singing. Objective things would be like the notes and the rhythms, the words, the dynamics, and then dramatic intent. You know what I mean? And by that, I don't mean dramatic choices. I mean, like, you know, we're going to talk a lot about how Milnes colors his voice through this. I think he does a great job. Sometimes people just are influenced only by the sound of the music and, oh, that's pretty music, so I'm going to sing this beautifully.
Right.
Sometimes the composer is actually trying to say something by putting words, setting those words in a way that is contrary to what the music is. And I think that that's just something that we should, as singers, as artists, kind of be cognizant of.
Yeah.
Subjective things, you know, it's things that are up to just, you know, I love that singer. I love that voice. I'm going to buy into that singer, you know, regardless of if their diction is not great, or Callas, people say how the mouthiness, I love Callas. I adore Callas. For me, I love Tibaldi too, but I'm not, you know, it's not the 50s where you have to love one or the other.
Right.
Love them both. And I unfortunately only know them through their recordings. And I'm just thankful that we even have that.
Sure. People used to talk all the time about how Tito Gobbi's voice wasn't the instrument that Leonard Warren or someone like that had.
Right.
But you look at the dramatic interpretation and the way that he used his voice, and that goes exactly with what you're saying. These are the subjective.
Quite frankly, technique is for us.
Right.
You know, these operas were recorded to play the opera and tell the music, tell the story, sing the music beautifully. You know, and so sometimes people don't sing the most accurate rhythms. hopefully they sing the right notes, but that happens too. You know, back when they were doing, you know, these, I mean, quite frankly, singers like Placido, and Milnes, who just did copious amounts of recordings, were doing these things either after rehearsal or between gigs in New York or in London or Rome. And they were roles they had been singing for 10 years. And you study something, but then once it grows into its own thing on the stage, you know, rhythms might slip, you know, a dotted rhythm becomes even, vice versa. And that's just, but it's not about being pedantic and giving them a check mark for everything they do right. It's just as singers who are learning roles, right? We should aim to do everything that is on the page. I mean, Verdi and Puccini and everybody after them wrote such details that, you know, and again, it's not about getting an A+. It's about understanding exactly what they meant when they wrote this and why they wrote it.
That's exactly right.
So that's the stuff that we're going to talk about. I think that's our intro. I think now we can go to Rigoletto.
Yeah.
You talk about just a little bit about the piece. Again, I'm not a music history major or teacher by any means. But I can tell you what I learned from looking it up on Wikipedia, that it
how many times you've been in the show? I mean, you know, we've done this.
I mean, I've sung at least 5 or 6 productions over 30 shows. I did know that it was premiered at Fenice because funny enough, right? Funny story. Robert Lyle, who is the music director of New Orleans, who I know you've worked with a lot, would say, can you imagine being in Fenice when this is the first time 4 trombones were used for things like the storm and stuff like that? You know, I've been to Fenice, I've sung, but at a private event, but Irini has sung there a couple of times.
Yeah.
It's not a big theater.
No. Even
after the fires have been rebuilt, they kind of were trying to keep it exactly what it was.
Yeah.
I can imagine what it was like for them to hear 4 trombones for the first time in such a small theater.
Well, even more so, can you imagine trying to keep the tune of La Donna Mobile secret until opening night?
They didn't give it to him until the night before the show.
Right.
So, I mean, obviously he was an Italian singer. I will next time maybe be even better prepared and have the first cast. But unfortunately, because we have no recordings, that doesn't mean anything other than, oh, I can research what else. I mean, for sure, there were a lot of singers who premiered multiple Puccini roles. Mm-hmm. And I think that's interesting when you hear like the Mimi was also the first Turandot or something like that.
Right.
Like, this is crazy.
Yeah. Because
those are completely different Fachs in today's world.
Yeah.
But anyway, so premiered in 1851 at Fenice. I seem to remember that my music history teacher at Loyola in undergrad, she wanted to argue that this is the first Verismo opera. Maybe not from a musical point as much as, it's not a happy ending story, obviously. The story is really about Rigoletto and him, I think. Well, I mean, I don't want to step on your toes here, but I think just it's really about a father, you know, trying to make his living in the world the best way he can, protecting his daughter by putting her in a convent, and then she comes home, and then even still keeping her under lock and key there.
Yeah. Yeah.
And trying to protect her, but yet she is her own person. And there's no way, no matter how hard he tries, that she is not going to spread her wings at some point.
Right.
And fly. And then the Duke is just kind of represents all the bad things of the world, especially from a relationship aspect. I mean, he's just
father's worst nightmare.
Father's worst. I mean, he is the guy, you know, when we were growing up, pulling up on the motorcycle with the leather jacket and whatever.
Right.
I don't even know what the equivalent of that would be for my daughters. I guess I'll find out in 10 years.
Hopefully not.
What the new version of that is going to be. But I can say that Verdi himself thought that this was a revolutionary work. I mean, they went to find a story that was going to be provocative. I mean, Le Rassemblement was written by Victor Hugo, of course, of Les Miserables fame. They were going for something to provoke. The Duke was based on Francis I of France. So that was that. I mean, for instance, there's the only aria Cabaletta, I think, if I'm not mistaken, is the Duke's in Act Two, El Mi Fu Rapita, Parmi, and then Possente Amor.
Yeah.
Everything else is very through composed, and even the storm and things like this are very integrated. I mean, it's very often done where Acts 2 and 3 are together, right?
Sometimes, yeah. I mean, I've certainly done it where hopefully there's a little bit of a break.
Yeah, I mean, usually a scene change, right? At least from the palace to Sparafucile's place. Because people say, well, Act 1 was the whole party scene.
Mm-hmm.
And then Act 2 was everything at Rigoletto's house. And then Act 3 was the palace. And Act 4 was Sparafucile. But I mean, I think now it's really just, they just do it with 2 big scenes in Act 1, take the intermission, go for 2. If they want to sell more drinks, they take another intermission. If they want to get everybody home, they do it without intermission.
Right.
So that's pretty much what I have to say about the piece itself. I mean, as we've said a number of times, we've got Luciano Pavarotti, who, I mean, I cannot say enough wonderful things about how much I admire his singing, how much I have learned from his singing.
And the guy, I mean, the guy along with Domingo and Carrera single-handedly brought opera into the living rooms of people who would never otherwise even be introduced to the art form with the three tenors, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, you can say what you want about these crossover guys, but, you know, Herbert Breslin, right, who was Pavarotti's manager and wrote that book, The King and I, which was kind of not really expose, but a little bit scandalous. And Luciano himself had a lot to say that was not, he did not agree with, but that, but there's a lot to be said from what, how he was able to take one of the biggest opera stars and make him a household name. Everybody knew Luciano with the scarf and that smile, his like larger than life stature, personality. I mean, you know, all those things. I mean, I think it's a combination of his charisma, the smile and the voice that made the world fall in love with him. And we still are. I did get to see him, but in an arena concert. So it's not, you know, I listened to stories of people in New York who heard him at the Met and in Philadelphia where he had his competition and other stuff like that. And they're like, you know, the voice was just so, I mean, you could say big, but it was really just present. It wasn't that it was heavy. It was super fresh and bubbly, but ringing and always just this like exciting sound. And of course I was happy just to pay the money just to see him in person, even if he was like way down there and I needed binoculars and what I was hearing could be very well just a CD that was being played while he mouthed along to it. But I didn't care. But then I juxtaposed that to the first time that I heard, Domingo, at the Met. And I just was like, wow, he was by far the biggest voice on the stage. And what he was singing, it was Merry Widow. So he was singing super suave and like, you know, not Parsifal or like Otello.
But he was like, Domingo?
Yeah. And I remember closing my eyes and thinking like he was right here.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that is a testament to the acoustic of the Met, but it's also the other singers didn't sound like that.
Well, yeah, I was going to say a testament to his technique, really.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, let's get going. Let's get going. I'm dying to listen to some reg here.
All right. Well, I kind of sort of know how to do this, but I am going to, I thought we would start with a little bit of Questo Quella just to get us in the party mood. And then we'll move on to where Rigoletto and Sparo Fucile meet, but we can have a little.
Sure.
I got to share my screen here. So share screen.
With sound.
Clicking on that, share computer sound. Although that was done before, now I guess I'm going to have to redo it. Any of you guys listening? Oh, that's one thing I forgot to say real quick. As an homage to Click and Clack, the Car Talk guys, we thought we would make this a call-in show. So we're going to have some guests, but we're also going to invite people to call in by clicking on the link that is in the YouTube live link. And we love to hear your questions and hear your comments and all those things. So here we go. Questo Quella, Luciano Pavarotti. How's the sound?
Questo Quella per me pari solo a quant'altre d'intorno, d'intorno mi vedo. Del mio cuore l'impero non cedo, meglio ad una che ad altre beltà. La costoro avvenenza è quel dono di che il fato le infiora la vita. So di questa mi torna gradita, forse un'altra, domani lo sarà un'altra, forse un'altra, domani lo sarà. Costanza tiranna del cuore detestiamo,
tiranna
del morbo, quel morbo crudele. So chi vuole si servi fedele, non m'avornono se non è libertà. De mariti il geloso furore, degli amanti le strani e derido, anco d'arco occhi di sfido, se mi punge, una qualche beltà, se mi quante beltà.
It doesn't get a whole lot better.
It does not get a whole lot better. I mean, you just hear the vibrancy and the excitement. I mean, you know, Luciano was maybe not celebrated as the actor that, say, Domingo or other people were.
Sure, but
you
but that
hear
voice,
everything
man.
In the voice. You hear the bubbly, like his charisma. Again, it, you just can't get away like from the attractiveness and the pull of that in the sound.
Yeah.
You know, one thing that, okay, so I went and read, he has a chapter in Great Singers on Great Singing, and it's gold, right? It's really, really gold. There's one thing that I find interesting, and I've heard him talk about it in other master classes on YouTube that I've seen that he does. And when he goes through the passaggio, he talks about squeezing. Now that's the word that he uses. Now, English is not his first language. He then also kind of says, well, it's not really squeezing of the muscles,
right.
But it's this. But there's definitely this idea of gathering the voice through the passaggio, right? Raccoglie la voce,
right.
Just to make it gathered through the passaggio. Pretty much every teacher I know, I think, would say that that's a good thing. Because you don't want to spread, because then when you bloom over the passaggio, there's no place left to go. You're just
right.
Spread and spread and spread the higher you go. One thing that I think is interesting, if you listen to that se mi punge, it's super like gathered, right?
Sure.
I mean, you could say maybe squeezed. Maybe he was doing that on purpose. I don't know. I mean, I think he definitely was, because this is like, it's super consistent.
Yeah.
I think he was really shrewd in his singing, and that's exhibited through his long career of being able to do that.
Well, you know what's interesting with Pav too is that he sang such a variety of repertoire, right?
Right.
I mean, he sang some of the stuff that nowadays would only be for the most dramatic, you know, tenor, and yet also some of the most light lyric stuff. And he just kind of had this technique and this voice that would that enabled him to kind of do it all, which is sort of, you know, the one of the most impressive parts of this.
Right. And so I think that and I think we will get to like some later stuff, right? Like when he did Trovatore and some of the other bigger stuff, and how that affected how it changed the way that he was singing things.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
But I do think that, you know, it's just interesting to hear how he did that. Because when I sing that, I think I sing say instead of see, because you can close. I mean, yeah, it's a closed vowel. You know, but I've often heard it said, or other people or whatever, that, you know, you want to close it in the mouth, but not in the throat, right?
Sure.
You want to make sure that the air is, that's still relaxed, that the air is still flowing. Again, not a criticism. It's just interesting to observe that that's how he does it. And he does it primarily on E vowels and O vowels, right? The ones that are either opened or closed vowels in the language of Italian. Perhaps it's something like that, and he doesn't even know that he's doing it, because he doesn't think in those terms because it's his language.
Right.
But I just find it very interesting. And you'll hear, we play a little bit of the El Sol dell'Anima, because it's hard as hell. And he handles it so beautiful that Adunque amiamoci donna celeste, di invidia uomini sarò per te. Beautifully, beautifully handled.
Right.
But my voice is different and I have to do it differently, but it's good for me. I mean, I tried to do it his way for a long time, and you know what? It didn't work for me. But that doesn't mean that I'm wrong or he's right. It's just different throats. It's different ways things go.
That's right.
Let's do a little bit of the Qual Vecchio Maledetto Diva Mi. And
right.
The
thing that's so interesting about this, right? So Montarone has come on and placed the curse over Rigoletto, and he's making his way back home, and he finds himself sort of not able to let this go, right? It's this curse that was placed that he feels so guilty and personally towards him. And I think that as he's sort of mulling this idea over before he runs into Sparafucile, he repeats, you know, quel vecchio maladiva mi, you know, this old man cursed me. What does that mean? What is going on with that? You know, but the thing that I think is so interesting in this recording, Milne's perhaps better than any other person I've ever heard, just is able to find this cupo, this kind of cover, this darkness that just so perfectly demonstrates the idea of storytelling. And so I just wanted to hear a little bit of that quel vecchio maladiva mi, the amount of space that this dude puts into his the way that he, let's say, refines the vowel.
Absolutely. And that's another point, right? Like, you can do things in a studio recording with the microphone right there that might not, you can find colors that might not carry on stage. And so it might be interesting, you know, he's probably playing with that. And I'm sure the engineer and the conductor are encouraging him to do things he can't do on stage and sing maybe softer or an even just different colors that might
not
carry so well. So here we go, Clodovecchio. Oh, just wanted to say, I mean, right, so Montoroni is this dad who's trying to like stand up for his daughter. So Rigoletto, I'm sure, sees himself in that guy, right? And he could kind of be cursed by himself.
Right.
I think that's part of the reason why he just can't let it go. Also, this is a completely superstitious time in history.
Of course.
You know, a curse like that.
It was meaningful.
They absolutely
believe. Say the least.
Right. So, all right, so here we go.
All right. I can't even hear that with, okay, push pause. I can't even hear that without just sort of this idea of, well, if we're going to talk like, how would you even talk like that?
Right.
I mean, it's unbelievable how much space.
Listen, Milnes, we know he sang all the big Verdi stuff. So that voice was sizable. And I'm sure he's just trying to capture that. And yeah, I agree with you. I mean, I don't even know. I have to think like the Cowardly Lion.
I mean, I talk oftentimes in my teaching that in order to find this sort of exaggerated operatic resonance, you know, it's neat to think of what if you have the worst head cold in the world and you had to sort of find that kind of resonance. But it's like he's able to create again with that cupo on top of it. So it's this, it's not just the sound with the resonance. It's this internal sort of interpretation that's just unbelievable. So it's just so great to hear.
I'm getting some comments from our viewers that we can't talk over the music when it's playing because then it cuts the music out completely.
Oh, okay.
And then also we need to not screen share for so long times because apparently I don't think they can see us very well. So you want to hear a little bit of Sparta Fucile there? You want to go right to
part? No, let's go. You know, the thing that I think also is so unique about these artists that we're listening to tonight, you know, in the next scene after he meets Sparta Fucile, he comes back to his home where he meets his daughter. And the beginning of that duet, maybe we could back it up just to the end of Parisiamo so we can hear how Milnes navigates the Anno e Folli, this beautiful exposed high G, right into the duet with Gilda. And the first thing that you hear after Milnes says Filia is Gilda singing Mio Padre.
Right.
And I think it's in this recording, it's so interesting to hear the way that the timbre matches one another with the amount of, again, the amount of internal loft or soft palate lift space, the way that Milnes refines the vowel. And then the way that Sutherland, I mean, it's like she was born without a soft palate. I don't understand how much.
It was so high all the time. You don't even hear it have to lift because it's just always up, right?
This
of gorgeous resonance. I mean, again, she was 6'4", right? And everyone says when you heard Luciano and Sutherland together, it was like the loudest thing you've ever heard.
I can only imagine.
Because of their stature and their efficiency and the ring and everything else. All right, so let's hear the end of Parisiamo, and then we will prepare to bring in our first Gilda, my dear, dear friend, Iglesias Gutierrez, student of Bill Schumann's and a graduate of the Academy of Vocal Arts, has sung Gilda all over the world. And we're going to hear from her about Caro Nome and the duet with Rigoletto and with the Duke. But here is the end of Parisiamo, getting into that duet.
Parisiamo.
I'm going to jump, there we go.
Quel vecchio maledito, tal pensiero perché conturba ognor la mente mia.
It's just it's so cool how it matches, you know.
Absolutely. I mean, and it's just like, you know, to hear again the kind of youthful quality in a singer who's 45, you know what I mean, at the time of this recording, it's just amazing. And that's so much. I mean, Gilda is so young and she's just out of the convent. I mean, I don't know why, but she's 15, something like that. And to play that, you know, we hear singers like do that for Butterfly and other things, but some don't do it so successfully because these are big sings, right? Mm-hmm. But not these legends. All right, so let's get L'Église in here just a second. Okay. L'Église, my darling, are you there? That's a beautiful picture of her daughter, Lucia. Yeah. There she is. Unmute yourself, my love. Press unmute.
Hello, Gordon.
Oh my God, this is welcome. So hearing all these amazing singers make me so emotional.
I know.
Bring me so many memories.
I know.
When I see this amazing role, this amazing opera with amazing singers, because I was so lucky enough to sing this with Brusson, with Renato Brusson, with Leonucci, with Rostovsky, and I mean, to not mention, but this is, I mean, I feel so emotional to hear this.
It's such amazing.
You know?
Well, we're so thankful that you're joining us for this. So tell us a little bit. You've sung it many, many times. Talk about, you know, how it's a very long scene here, right? How you've got the duet with Rigoletto and then the duet with the Duke and then Caro Nome after that. And then you have to get carried off the stage and hope nobody drops you. What is that like on the stage?
I mean, like you cannot drink even a little bit of water. It's back to back and very emotional because this, the first duet with Gilda and Rigoletto is so powerful, you know?
Yeah.
What she's telling her all about the life, over, you know, she was wondering all over and over how was, you know, about her mother, about so many things.
Yeah.
And when he tells all these sad things, oh my God, it's really beautiful and in the same time very emotional. So you have to control yourself at some point because also vocally is very difficult.
Right.
Technically, you know, it's very difficult. Plus, after that beautiful, amazing duet, then you have another big duet with the Duke.
Yeah. And then this killer aria with these E flats exposed, which I've...
Yes.
There are
and then after that, the aria. So imagine how the concentration you have to have and the control you need to have.
I mean, at least the Duke and Rigoletto get to kind of warm up a little bit easily. Questo, quella, not that hard. We have the whole first scene to kind of...
Yeah, the big first party scene.
Right.
nothing.
Yeah, and you have to come out of the gate ready to go. It's like, it's exactly. more like, you know, Radame is like Celeste Aida within a minute of stepping on stage, right?
Right, right. And so then...
Go ahead.
Yeah, and then you have to be fresh for Karonome. Because then, right. if you don't sing well Karonome, people will, that's it. You
it's know? Going to be a long evening for the rest of the show.
Yeah, right.
Exactly.
So did you listen to Sutherland when you were learning opera and growing up? Are you familiar?
Yeah. Oh my God. Of course, she's one of my idols.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I love her so much.
And do you feel yes. like you approach things similarly to how she does, or do you think differently?
I do believe, yes, in her technique, yes. I feel very, you know, similar.
Yeah, it's
with her technique.
Yeah. Iglesias and I study with the same teacher, Bill Schumann, so I know obviously yes. he teaches his sopranos yes. a little bit differently than his tenors. But, you know, I do know a little bit because I sit in on some of his things at ABA. And Sutherland in her book talks about, it's so funny the way she words this, because she says this iniquitous forward placement, right? Which I'm like, right. iniquitous means like terrible, morally abhorrent, like all these things. But she's actually saying it sarcastically, which is kind of hard to infer over a book. But Jerome Hines kind of says that. And so, yeah, she just likes that bright, ringy, masky feeling, but obviously with the dome.
But inside mm-hmm. she's very, you know,
yes.
warm. I mean, like she doesn't say, she does it like this, but inside is not like this.
Right.
You know, so it's like a combination.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, Pavarotti, we tell the story all the time that he didn't learn how to breathe in support until she taught him how to when they were doing wow. their tour, I think of Lucia in Australia. Mm. And you think, well, how could he not know how to support because he was already doing it? But I'm sure he meant like he just didn't quite understand how much he can give over to the air if you get out of the way and you actually yeah. use the air to support your throat. So you and Weston discuss about the about this duet, which is you guys tell me about that.
Oh my God.
It's exactly what Iglesias is saying. I mean, it's so incredibly emotional, and it's
exactly
it really walks the wire between or balance between not giving yourself permission to start falling into what it is that you're talking about. Because if you start to experience those emotions, and if you start to, I mean, I'll never forget, I was learning my first Rigoletto when my daughter, Amelia, was about to be born. And I had this like picture and this thought about what it would be to have a daughter and to have it's this type such of a relationship. Beautiful. And it's unbelievable. But yeah. For me personally, I think that act one, I mean, like Brian was saying, like you get a little bit of time chance to warm up and so forth, but like the Parisiamo going into this duet, for some reason, the way it's written in the passaggio or the way it's just, it's the most so tiring,
difficult.
It's the
so
most,
difficult. Yes, I know.
And for the soprano, of course, it's a marathon.
But I know in this duet, all baritones tell me this exactly the same thing. This duet.
I remember singing at one point and like coming off stage after it, and I like immediately called my teacher. I was like, I think I'm losing my voice. I don't know what's going on with me. I was like, so, and he goes,
because it's moving down in the passaggio all the time.
It's
no?
totally, it's just
all the time right in the passaggio,
and then constantly right. going up above and then coming back exactly. and then going right in the middle.
Plus, what you are saying to me,
right.
So it's so all the emotion and oh my God.
Yeah, yeah.
So do you guys want to listen to anything specific from this recording or just throwing it out there?
Well,
maybe near the end of the duet, you know, when it's sort of, you know, she's like, yes, I'll be good. I'll stay home. And you know, because once he's decided to leave, maybe, I don't know, the last minute or so of the,
Avelia Donna.
Yeah, before Giovanna.
Right. So I'm going to give you the last minute or so. If you want to hear that, or
no, but I mean, that was that, you know, it, that is that emotional part that Iglesias is talking about. Where
this part, oh my god,
oh, I mean, it's like I was getting goosebumps, just like listening to it.
I know,
it's so good,
yeah. All right, so that's awesome. Let's talk a little bit about how this duet with the soprano, the El Sol del Anima, how is it for you? Because I can tell you for the tenor, it's hard as hell, you know, I mean, the chromatic going up and then having to go amiamo ci so softly while you're singing your ha, 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 ha.
I know.
It's, you know, I was given this role to learn way too early in my career. And so I had a lot of bad habits with it, and I learned it. I've worked it with three different teachers. So I don't look for this role as a job anymore. If it happens and I'm free and I'm like, okay, let's do it. Otherwise, there's just too many different like muscle memories, and like each one of them I really ingrained to try to forget the other muscle memory, and now it's just a hodgepodge of all of that. But what's the how is this duet for you, Iglesias? Is it less difficult than the Rigoletto one? More difficult? You know, what do you want to do and not do leading into?
It's different because this is less like emotional. Right. It's different,
yeah.
But technically also, oh my God. I mean, I studied this with Renata Scotto. When I did my debut in Rigoletto, she even went to see me. You know, it was very nice.
She's in, so in Connecticut.
And she was, oh my God, the style and so many things. But I think the duet with the Rigoletto,
mm-hmm.
I feel more.
Yeah. I mean, I would hope that Verdi would kind of give you guys a little bit of a break before he knows he's about to write this.
Right. The first duet is, for me, is more difficult than the second duet with the Duke. Of course, the second duet is so difficult.
Right.
Of course. Right. But I mean,
I would love to listen to just a little bit of, you know, where she sings and he says, you know, where he bursts in and he's like, Tamo, Tamo.
Yeah.
You know? So let's do that. Let's get into there. And then we'll listen to a little bit of El Sol del Anima as well.
Oh my God. Sol del Anima. That is for the joke.
All right.
Beautiful.
Rispondo a due che sono, ma lo son tutto un mondo. Chi ma chi
God. Beautiful. Wow, stunning.
It's unbelievable when you hear the dynamics that they're using and the control and the, I was thinking, you know, how do you teach that? You know, how you can't. I
mean, exactly.
It's just.
Oh my God. Also the energy between them.
Yes. Right.
You can feel it.
Yeah. And like, you know.
The connection.
Listen, that duet for me for the tenor, it was the hardest thing I'd ever sung probably for the first 10 years of my career. And it's still not something that I enjoy singing from a technical aspect. It's beautiful and it's exciting, but it's just so demanding and there's very little margin of error, right? And to hear how he handles that and like, you know, that cadenza, right? The full cadenza that they did in this, it's in the score, is almost never done, right, Iglesias? I mean, I don't think I've ever done the full cadenza on stage.
Oh, I did.
Yeah. Because usually, you know, they just go, and they go, ha, 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 ha. And so in listening to this, I realized that he sings kind of oh, and then when he goes low, he sings ah. So again, he's trying to gather voice through the passaggio so that it doesn't spread, so that when he goes up,
exactly,
he blooms and then beautifully. Right?
Just unbelievable.
But yeah, so gorgeous. So moving from Caporonome, is there anything that you want to hear from this recording, or do you want to talk about what?
Well, I have a question. I have a question for Iglesias. You know, every soprano that I've talked to about this role, they always talk about how they love the role, but they hate Caporonome because it's so different from the rest of the role, or it gives them, you know, poses technical challenges. So I'm curious to hear your interpretation. Like, do you feel that it sits well within the rest of the role, or do you feel like it sticks out because it's, I mean, I don't know. Do you enjoy singing it even as a standalone aria?
It's difficult, you know, because Caporonome is extremely naked aria.
Right.
And sometimes it's not, I mean, you have to be at some point a little bit in your brain. You have to be a little bit cold to don't lose to your, you know, your control.
Mm-hmm.
In order to, you know, to finish gracefully this aria with the amazing cadenza, and the people can get, you know, these right. feelings, because you have, this is what is difficult about this. It's one of the most difficult aria.
Yeah.
To be honest with you, and especially when you sing the whole thing without, you know, having any break.
Well, we are going to post, with your permission, a video of a recording of you doing this. I think it's either from Rome. I don't know. Bill was telling me there's one with hundreds of thousands of views. And just in case any of our younger listeners who are still studying might not have heard you sing or had the pleasure to sing with you, like Wes and I have, it's stunning. We play it for everybody who has not heard you. We say, you got to listen to this. And
for what?
Sing it beautifully. Your Caporonome, that's on YouTube.
You don't know, but you don't know the story about this Caporonome. This Caporonome I sing in the competition that I won inside in Finland.
I think there's two, right? There's the competition.
This one?
From Roma, right? Is there one from Rome or no? Is it only the one from the competition? I don't know. I just type in Iglesias Gutierrez Caporonome and that's what comes
up. Just too late with orchestra, you mean? The yeah. one who I sing with orchestra?
Yes.
It cost me 1 year to accept. Friend of mine, I want to put this. It took me 1 year.
Well, you're too strict on yourself. I can tell you, it's gorgeous.
And look what happened. I don't understand. I hear it has hundreds
of thousands of views. So we're going to post
it. Oh my God. In the description. This is crazy.
People can go and click on it and hear you sing it. Well, listen, thank you so much, Iglesias. I know it's getting late.
I love you, and I'm so happy to see you. I'm so happy to see Weston.
It's
I mean,
so happy. I'm so glad to see you.
You are such a wonderful friend of mine, and I will never forget when I sing with you both. I mean, I never in my life.
I think about our Traviata all the time.
I know. It was so. It's a bless to have you.
Yeah.
And
thank
our
you.
Puritani.
Hi,
in Athens. Oh my God.
You took such great care of me during that, and I was sweating blood singing Puritani. Actually, the only
oh, what a bless! What a bless!
And Iglesias had done it a number of times, and so she was just able to, I remember singing, waiting.
You were amazing.
And just looking at her.
Oh
her
my God, please.
Like, you're going to do this. You're going to sing so beautifully. And when I would
go. But you were so amazing. Come on.
Thank you. When I would get to the C sharp, she would smile like it was the best note she ever heard.
What it was. But it was. It
she
was.
Made me feel like it was amazing.
Excuse me.
Oh, that's so good.
We should all be so lucky to have colleagues as gracious and as
wonderful. Oh my God, it's important. Exactly. I know.
Well, listen, give Lucia a big hug for us and thanks for joining. And
okay, you too, my beautiful girls. I love you.
Love you too. We'll talk soon.
Bye.
Thank you so much.
And so we have. Sorry. We have a caller coming in.
Oh,
a good buddy of ours, Jeff Monette.
Oh, okay.
While I wait for the for Zoom to bring him in, I just want to say one thing that when Iglesias was talking about that Puritani, it brought to mind, so Luciano was the recording that I listened to a lot for Puritani.
Yeah.
And his studio recording, he does it in all the keys. So we're talking high Ds. He even throws in that very famous falsetto high F at the end. But in the live recordings, he always took the duets, which have the D, the duet that has the D in it, down a half step. So they were only C sharps. They're still amazing. But I mean, this is the kinds of things that opera companies are not ashamed, or at least at that time, they were not ashamed to take things down a half step so that you could still have a voice like Pavarotti's or Corelli's. I mean, they do it still with Di Quella Pira, I guess now. They'll put it in B natural for some tenors. You know, most of the audience, unless you're a singer or incredibly savvy or have perfect pitch, wouldn't even know that it's down a half step. And it would be, what a shame not to hear a voice like that sing that music just because they're not sticking to the D, you know, high D and all this stuff, which the pitch is already higher now than it was back then, but that's for a different night. I got Jeff here. Jeff Monette, you coming in?
It's like the, there we, okay, there we go.
There he is.
Unmute.
There's an unmute thing that I just pressed.
Sorry, you
excellent. It's
working. We can hear you now. So welcome. You're our first official caller into the listening lab. So what's on your mind?
Oh man, just listening to those people sing is just ridiculous. It kind of it brings back memories of whenever you first listen to amazing music, like when you're an undergrad and you know, and you're up in the listening library. And you know, just pouring through. But this is old school, so this is like Dewey Decimal System.
Right.
You were talking about how people have Spotify, but I'm dating myself. I mean, whenever we would go to the library, I mean, it was like card catalog, you know, and it was LPs, and it was drop the LP. But that's the way we learned music back then. I mean, we would go to friends' houses. And Weston knows we had a bass that, and he had this huge record collection. And he studied with one of my teachers, Giorgio Trotsky.
Wait, are you talking about Brian Banyan?
Oh my God. And he had this, and David Hart, remember Davis Hart? He had old reel to reel. He had the cylinders. So you would go to his house and it, you know, you would listen to these old Bastianini cylinders on these it was just, there's a certain way to listen to these things, you know, not that I don't appreciate it, but like it floods the memories back of listening to the LPs and having the cover art and listening and just, oh,
it's awesome.
It's really amazing.
Yeah. One of the teachers here at Loyola that teaches with Irini has a Victrola, and he played an old Caruso cylinder for me. And I was like, this is straight up like witchcraft magic here. There's no electricity. There's no nothing. You crank it up and it starts playing and it sounds like Caruso is like inside that box somehow.
Wow. Yeah. And correct me if I'm wrong, but the way that those did it, there was literally the microphone. They picked up by the pressure of your instrument. So you had to be.
They sang right into the acoustical horn. Caruso, you know, was a caricaturist and he's drawn a couple of caricatures where he was, you know, doing that. I mean, his face is practically in the cone, right? Right. And let me tell you, they didn't have, that was a one take only thing. There was no, photoshopping of the voice at that time. It says when you were saying you're going over to your buddy's house. I mean, my bud, Rob Nauman, who was, we were at Loyola together. He still lived with his parents and they had like a beautiful house with a big pool table and a great stereo system. So we literally would take these CDs like this and the Pav Franny Bohem, and Tosca and Butterfly and put them on and just listen to them cover to cover while we're shooting pool, ordering pizza.
And your jaw was just dropping. I mean, you almost didn't know what you were listening to. And then now listening to it at our advanced I mean, we bring a whole different appreciation to it, you know.
Our maturity and knowledge and perspective. Yes, Jeff.
Well, speaking of experience,
yeah,
Jeff, you've sung this opera before.
Correct.
What was your experience with that? What role did you sing? Who directed it? What are your memories?
I was Marullo.
And this is way back before even 2003. So before mini disc or anything, this is at IU with Tito Capobianco.
Nice.
Yeah. So Tito is a force of nature. You know, the memories, because we were double cast in that. And I mean, the way he staged first scene with the Duke, you know, he was so intense and he was so methodical. And, you know, we had had some other roles, Wes and I were double casting other things, but his intensity and his rehearsals really kind of opened my eyes to, okay, this is still college, but the way that he expected his singers to bring their performance, it was more of a professional level, just with what he wanted and how he was expecting from me and everyone else in the cast.
I mean,
he didn't care.
He directed everywhere, right? Like, he started doing stuff at AVA, unfortunately, after I had already graduated. But, I mean, he was everywhere. I mean, he knew everybody.
He founded Pittsburgh Opera. He founded San Diego Opera. He created the American Opera Center that became the Juilliard Opera Center. I mean, he was a titan in this industry.
Yeah. Absolutely. And he expected, like you said, he had very high standards, but you never questioned what his motivation was. He wanted to do these pieces in the way that is deserving and respectful of the telling mm-hmm. the story, being true to the score. I know that, you know, even though I didn't work with him, AVA would have never brought him back if he wasn't so faithful and respectful of what the composer had written and doing that. So
my specific memory that I just wanted to bring is I remember, because, you know, Marullo, he was one of the kind of leaders of the bad part of it. And he was kind of, you know, the abduction scene was a real sticking point for Tito, because he had seen so many productions that he didn't like, because, you know, you have to do this amount of stage business on this beat, and there's not a lot of time, and it all has to match the text. And he had seen so many productions not actually work and make it believable.
Well, quite frankly, unfortunately, I think that's why people think that opera singers are not very good actors. And it's not that we're not good actors, it's that we're kind of tied to the timing of the music. And if the conductor is not cognizant of what's going on stage and watching and caring, then of course, when you have musical beats to hit that aren't in the place that you're used to them hitting, it just looks like I can't say it on air,
right? But
let's just say it doesn't look believable.
You remember, Weston, how he really took enough time to every bit, you know, made sense in that scene, to where it wasn't like, oh, well, then it was very truthful and kind of, like you said before, this kind of original attitude, like, you know, you knew it's doom, you knew what was going to come up with Spar for Chile, you know, but it had to make sense dramatically.
Right.
Right.
Well, he would, you know, he preached about how this opera is in the height of the romanticism. And he would talk about, you know, what does this mean? The relationship, you know, and he was just so incredibly passionate about exactly what you just said, Jeff, like the relationships on stage. It didn't matter if you were, you know, chorus member number four, or if you were Marullo, or if you were Giovanna, or if you were Rigoletto or the Duke or whatever, you were the most important person in that scene. And he flushed it out so well that it was just like a beautifully choreographed sort of, you know, moving piece. It's unbelievable. And I will say, since we're talking about him, comes the best quote in the world. He asks the question, what is opera? And he tried to get us to guess for about 2 days during these classes that he taught while he was there directing the show. And we would always try to guess, I don't know, is opera maybe a play set to music where everything is sung? And he would look at you like,
you know,
how dare you? How dare you come at me?
Quit looking at the cucarachas.
Right, right, right. So he finally writes it down on a piece of paper. And for whatever reason, he picked me to come up and read it. So here's what was written on that piece of paper. Opera is a hurricane of passions, of which the singing human voice is the epicenter, dragging fiercely all the arts with it in a sublime and romantic psychosis of insatiable sensuality.
I mean, that should be the definition of opera in the New Grove Dictionary.
Exactly. It's.
I mean,
somebody has put that on the tombstone. My God.
Yeah, right.
Well, listen, Jeff, thank you so much. We've got our second Gilda on the line here. So
oh, good.
Dear friend, Mary Dunleavy. We're going to welcome her in 30 seconds. But Jeff, thank you so much. Jeff and Weston have known each other for a while. We all met in Aspen in 2003.
Yeah.
And I was able to just see Jeff not that long ago when my family was visiting Weston and his family in Houston. So I'm just so thankful. Thanks for calling in, Jeff. Great to see you. And, you know, we look forward to seeing you again soon. Okay.
I'll see you tomorrow.
Awesome.
Ciao.
All right, guys.
Oh.
All right. So I'm going to go ahead and get Mary in here, and I'm going to get myself another Coke Zero because I've gone through it. But here comes Mary.
All right. Hi, Mary.
Hello.
Oh my gosh, it's so good to see you.
I'm so happy to see you guys. Here, I gotta get Brian on my screen too.
Oh, he Brian stepped away to grab another drink.
A little break for another one.
Yeah, right. A little Coke Zero action.
Oh, that's so fun.
How have you been? You been well?
I'm good.
Good.
I'm bored.
I hear you.
Y'all bored too?
We should sing an opera together. That'd be fun.
Let's do it.
Let's do it.
Yeah. We didn't sing, none of us sang Rigoletto together.
No, we sang Traviata together.
Traviata, we did Faust.
Faust together, yeah. So
I've been loving listening to all these stories and the clips and...
Oh, good.
I think it's fun. I hope people like it. I mean, you know, if not, at least we like it and we've had fun doing it and we're going to keep doing it, so...
We'll keep listening.
So tell us, okay, so you have got Act Two, which is a bit, I mean, it's a big scene. It's not the marathon, but it's very intense, you know, and the Si Vendetta and the Tutte le Feste and telling the story again, so emotionally heartbreaking of Rigoletto coming in and finding her, you know, disheveled and assuming and, you know, what's going on. And I'm gonna let you guys tell me about that because I'm usually getting a sip of water, getting ready for La Donna Mobile in act three. So fill me in.
Right. Well, I know Weston knows that, you know, your aria is so heartbreaking. And yeah, the whole show stopped there.
Yeah, I mean for me, the marathon, I mean, like I said, in act one, I mean I think that duet in act one is the hardest sing of the night. I don't know why. I mean, probably because of the passaggio, but this is the marathon for me. So I come out, you know, we sing the whole opening thing and we do the Cortigiani, which then leads into Gilda, all right? And I mean, when that duet happens, the one moment where I'm like, is when you get to tell me, I'm like, please talk to me. Tell me everything about what
can
happened.
I stop singing now? Can you start singing
can
now?
Can I just look up stage and just wipe the sweat off my face in this moment?
Right. Rigoletto is very sweaty in this moment.
Yeah, right.
Where Johnny like wipes you out.
Oh, God. That's got everything, right? It's got the horrendous pissed off, you know, emotion tied in with the just he, you know, halfway through decides that the only thing he can do is beg and plead for the, you know, and then there's that, and then that moment when she comes out, you know, the pod, I'm like, it's so hard to keep your cool and your calm in all of that emotional, you know, turmoil. And and then you still have to, I still have to like get them off. And so that sounded terrible. I still have to get rid of them, you know, off stage. I just remember, I remember thinking to myself in those moments of just like, okay, it's time for me to stop singing for a little bit. And that's why I always look forward to that moment where I'm just like, parla. You know, like
come slowly.
Yeah, and then and it's just such beautiful, but innocently beautiful. I mean, I just think Verdi, I mean, obviously he does such an incredible job with this painting of like the vocal line being exactly the emotions and the experiences that you must have just gone through, you know.
Yeah, I mean it's funny because it's like the un-aria, right? It's right. You have Caronome, which is everybody's audition aria and everybody's competition aria. And it's the showstopper, and it's the thing that gives you a heart attack before every show, right? That's the
What, yeah, what, just out of curiosity, what is your thought about that? Do you enjoy singing Katanome? Do you look forward to it? Do you think it, you know, is it one of those things, like I know people talk about Violetta, for example, one is so different than two and it's different from three. Do you feel like Katanome sits with the rest of the role nicely, or do you think it's, okay, no.
Yeah, no.
Yeah.
No, I think it's very much the Traviata thing, right? You already talked to Iglesias about this, is like the marathon first act, right? You come on and you don't leave.
Right.
And the very end of it is the bleeping as hard as aria.
Right.
You know, and it's so still and so quiet. And it's similar to A Forse Lui, where everything kind of just stops, right? And everybody leaves. And then you just start from nothing again with that, you know, Estrano or, you know, Gualtier Malde, that exposed E natural is like, you've got to have everything down and out and relaxed, or you're a goner.
There you go.
I used to think that high E flat at the end of the tenor duet would kind of like gave me that release, like da da, and I'd be like, okay, now I can take a chill pill.
Did you? I mean, I'm sure that you know everybody's an admirer of Sutherland. Did you listen to her as far as like someone to like either just kind of like emulate, or do you feel like her voice is similar or different, and how so? And just what did you think? At the time, and maybe what do you think now about how she approaches this and what you do differently and all those kinds of things?
Yeah, so I mean, when I was learning, you know, back in the day, we had to have LPs as well. And I think maybe we started cassettes and stuff, but I accumulated a lot. Like I really wanted to listen to a lot of different people, especially when I was doing it the first time. And I feel like I took pieces from everybody. And I feel like for me, Sutherland is this amazing coloratura technician. Like it's her coloratura and her tippy top that's like phenomenal. Right. And the way she can just dink, I just touch it, right? And like it doesn't ever have to be, it's never a hard landing on her notes. Right. But for me, I need like a callus or scatto for the pathos, for the honesty, for the stuff that really gets me. So for me, Sutherland never touches my heart.
Yeah.
She never gets there, but she's beautiful. It's like a beautiful sound. Absolutely. But it doesn't give me the emotional content that I want.
I don't think that we should be, I mean, again, it doesn't have to be a criticism as much as it can be like an observation that, I mean, you know, for instance, it is no secret that she did not have a diction that was, you know, that of Scotto or stuff. It's not that she didn't care about the words. It's just that her approach to technique was that she would rather have a cleaner, you know, more crystalline sound in her ear than she would to overly labor over the syllables in the text, quite frankly.
Right.
But really not the text. It's, you hear that she knows and it has an intent in what she's singing, but she doesn't allow her emotion to overtake the technical aspect. And I agree with you. I'm not that kind of singer. I am more of a, you know, passion driven. And sometimes I use the text and the words in a way that's probably too forceful, but that's my personality. That's my voice. At this point, 20 years of singing, I know what helps my voice. And I know that if I get too much in my head, you can see it on my face, 'cause I look like I'm just like out to lunch and only thinking. And especially today's opera public, they want to see a fully engaged actor singing this beautiful music.
Of course, yeah.
I will
say, that's why you have to have that technique, the technique that allows you to do, you really need to be a painter, right? And you want to have all your colors and your full palette. And if you only have this kind of beautiful column of air that can never be interrupted by the, you know, you're actually making the sound,
then,
like, what's the point in my opinion?
Beautiful
sounds are great, but like I also want to have something else. I need more than that.
Well, yeah, and they're beautiful and they're spectacular, but they're also like, you know, these are 3-hour long operas. If you're just listening to beautiful sound after beautiful sound, it gets a little bit like, okay, what else is going on?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, opera in the theater is as much visual as it is auditory, and so you've got to split that difference. I mean, that's what the opera public, as you guys all know, expects today.
Yeah.
You know, there's no longer park and bark. That is not acceptable from the public standpoint, certainly not from a stage director standpoint. So yeah, I think that it's great. One thing that I do find interesting, and Wes and I are going to talk about this a little bit when we get to Milnes in the last act, is that she has such clean attacks on her top. Very few scoops. If there's any kind of like, whoa, it's up there. Like it has a dramatic intent, vocal intent, and it's not a crutch. And I am not into scooping. It's different than portamentos, but I know a lot of tenors in particular, and it's probably because I've done a lot of French music and I had to train it out of myself, that you can't do it. But she's, I do admire that a lot with her. And yeah. So you guys want to hear any of Tutte le Feste or Si Vendetta? What do you guys, what's up? I'm your
I was just going to tell you a little like story I had from one of my little, my first Gilda was actually at the Met, which sounds crazy. It was literally my role debut, which was-
That is crazy, but good for you.
But anyway, then I did it in a bunch of other smaller places. And then my last one was at San Francisco. So I feel like I started high, went down low, and then but-
I mean, listen, and Mary, I know you, whether you're singing it, if we're singing in Birmingham or you're singing at the Met, you were given the same performance.
Exactly.
I know that you're not. You talked about that a lot. The stakes are higher for us because it's more visible in the New York Times and all that stuff, and it's the Met. But don't sell yourself short. You know, I know whether you were in Birmingham or any of those places, you were given it like it was your Met debut. So tell us a story. We love stories.
So anyway, I'm in my dressing room warming up and the conductor comes in and he says, you know, what are you doing? I'm like, well, I'm warming up. And of course, warming up, guess what I was warming up? I was warming up my top voice. I was warming up my C's and E flats and you know whatever, and he's like, "What you've got to do is you got to look at this Tutte le Feste as this. The thing about Tutte le Feste, it's E to E, yeah. Almost the entire aria, right? And that's not where sopranos normally have their bread and butter, right?
Yeah. Right.
And also Tutte le Feste is there's basically a new syllable on every word. I mean, a new syllable on every note.
Yeah.
And he gave me this idea and this technique or idea of trying it out myself of really matching this, and I was still keeping the honesty of the words because this is a story she has to tell and it can't be just beauty. It's really a story. It's a narrative, right? Where Caronome, you keep saying the same thing over and over again, more or less, but Tutte le Feste, you're getting information. You're getting narrative of the story, right? It's a plot line.
Right.
So it's very important to really explain the and be clear. But this idea of like making this dip down from like B natural, I think it is, be natural to low E and then back up to E. And then all of a sudden you're ending with an A and like all of a sudden those G's and A's feel really high. But to make this like that it's not three different voices or two different voices, right? That it's all in line and all matched up and that they're all vibrating and resonating the same way. And it's not just, the one trick pony of the staccati and the.
And who was that conductor?
Conductor was Stephen Mercurial.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah. There you go.
He's moved on to, doing a lot of, he does a lot of pop concerts and stuff.
Yeah. I'm aware, but I'm also aware that it pays him very well. He's one of Bill Shulman's neighbors in the Ansonia apartment up in the Upper West Side. But, listen, just to touch back on the great singers and great singing, Sutherland does not get super into this. And she only says a couple of things, but one of the things that she does say is what you were talking about and what Stephen told you is that the voice, whether it's the top or whatever, is anchored in the middle of the words that she used, right? And anchor is maybe a little bit too solid for my terminology, but definitely that the foundation of the middle and having that easy and not getting a little bit top heavy. I think it's great. My first teacher took my top and then tried to build everything else to match it. And I think that was a little bit cart before the horse because it took me a very long time to understand how to relax my throat and sing the bottom octave of my voice and have the air actually move through it as opposed to just being like snarly and get it out there.
Right.
It was like, I'm going to relax. Now I can move air through that because it's relaxed. Oh, and now my top is like twice as free and ringing. But I knew nothing about opera at the time. It's not a criticism of him. I'm sure he tried it the other way, but I just didn't get it. So we love the stories. Listen, do you guys want to hear anything of this?
Well, yeah, why don't we hear just the last, you know, the Si Vendetta, you know, where we get a verse from Rig and a verse from Gilda, and then to the end.
That's a fun thing to sing.
Oh, it is great. It's great.
Right? Wasn't that fun? It's like off to the races. Go.
Right.
And big.
And then figuring out how to meet in the middle for the cadenza.
Exactly.
All right, so we're going to look at, say, the last little bit of this.
It's so interesting hearing you talk about that, Mary, with the, you know, if you think about what she's actually saying in those moments, you know, you don't necessarily hear that portrayed through the way that she's singing. It's so beautiful. And it's so
beautiful. Yeah. And it's exciting. It's that energy, excitement.
Absolutely. I mean, I think she chooses to keep her excitement for the high note.
Right.
Because if she went after it too much, like Mary was saying, if you go after it too much in that middle voice and you like chest that stuff, or you just go after it, you're not going to get the high note that is free and as easy to like sustain. But of course, it's totally tempting. I mean, we've all been there where it's like, oh man, the orchestra is so big at this point, I just have to get that sound out. Well, you pay for it. Sooner or later, you're going to pay for it.
Yeah. And then how fortunate that Milnes' top is like, I mean, I don't know what his highest note he could sing, but you know, we'll get to it again at the very end. But I mean, that A flat that he sings so effortlessly and exciting, you know, it's not just floating, it's like in there. And I mean,
What I love about that kind of thing, right, is that she gets her high note while he's taking it easy, and then he gets his high note while she's taking it easy.
Right.
It's not like we're both singing a high C and we're like, how long are we going to hold this? So it's like, you know, Rigoletto's like, Jill, to hold it as long as possible because it gives me more time to like swallow and go, ha ha.
Right, right.
You know? And she's like, once her high note's over, she's relieved. Like, hold it as long as you want.
That's funny. That is a good part about doing the duet with baritones in general,
right?
Yeah. As we always like try to, you know, hold at the same time and finish together. And
sure,
it's true.
I love that Verdi way of doing it. We don't have to be so perfect.
Totally, and just to reiterate and double down on that, like, you know, I love like these, you know, Gedda is the equivalent, right, for a tenor, like someone who just was such a technician and could sing anything so beautifully at any dynamic. It's just, you know, if you love Gedda, you're probably not going to love Corelli. You're not going to love, maybe even Luciano might be a little bit not like classy is the wrong word, but like, just say like really, I mean, you know, like Caruso was really classy. Mm-hmm. Gigli was a little bit too much, but those guys sang with such pristine technique compared to today's standards.
Mm-hmm.
Like it just like they never sacrificed beauty of tone for dramatic intent, because that's not the opera world they were in at the time.
Right.
You know, but when we got, you know, when things started rolling and people started singing a bit more realistically, it was no longer, even by the time we got to Callas and these guys, they were all about committing to the drama and not being perfect. I mean, there's a famous interview with John Vickers that where he's talking about Callas was singing something, maybe Tosca, and she was cracking this one note kind of like show after show. And he just said, why don't you just sing it a little louder? And she was like, because I don't feel like singing it a little bit louder. My emotion has to, I have to sing it in this way. And if it cracks, it's unfortunate, but she was, you know, and that's what he's saying. She was such a true artist that she would not let her ego supersede the character that she was trying to portray just so that she wouldn't crack. She would rather be true to the piece and the character than do something that was to fan her own ego and make people say, you know, not have anything to critique. And I mean, that's just a huge, there are a lot of singers singing today that I've sung with, I'm sure we all have, that could take a note, a page from that playbook. Sure. That it maybe not just about your ego and your applause and your affirmation that you need from doing this.
Yeah.
That was something that we always kind of had, not really beaten, but instilled in us at ABA, that, you know, opera is like a religion there. This is about respect. This is about gratitude. You are lucky to be able to have the talent to sing a role like this. To be approach that score humbly and respectfully, it just opens your eyes in a different way. And quite frankly, at 41 now, I understand there are roles that I've sung that I'm not going to sing again. The time for that has passed because I can't sit in that tessitura anymore. Now there's other repertoire that I've been able to move on to. But you realize, I have realized in that your time with these roles is limited. And especially like, you know, when performances in opera world, we don't know what's going to happen. You know, some of the performances that we gave may be the last time we have sung those particular roles. And that perspective gives you like a humility that's like, yeah, I'm going to make every day count now. I'm going to make every practice session, every rehearsal, even the ones I don't enjoy or too early in the morning or whatever.
Right.
I'm going to think and remind myself again, the lockdown and this whole thing has brought all these silver linings to the front of our consciousness to just be like, you know,
don't take anything for granted anymore.
I mean, the life is tough. Traveling is tough. Having to sing at your best almost all the time is tough, but we're still lucky to be able to do it. Right?
Yeah.
I want to ask if you guys noticed that with not having to sing and perform the last 9 months that, or more or less, I'm sure you're doing something, but have you noticed that your voice seems like super healthy and ready to go every single day?
Absolutely.
Why can't I go on?
I've never sung better in my life.
I mean, like, yeah. Fresh as a daisy.
Fresh as a daisy.
I don't have too much Grey Goose the night before. but yeah, I mean, absolutely. Oh, look at it. You can see it right over my shoulder there.
Actually. There you go.
Yeah, no, I mean, that again, silver linings have been the voice being fresh, time to learn things that I didn't have time to learn before, time to spend with my family. I mean, we've spent more time together in these past 7 or 8 months than we have since they've been born. And yeah. Anna is 5 and Ava will be 7. And we're doing stuff around the house and we're actually enjoying our house. Or I should say I am. I mean, Irini's been here with the girls a lot more than I have in the past couple of years, but I'm like, oh, this is a great place. It's a great neighborhood. It's not even just nice for like a week at a time. It's actually very comfortable and nice for to live.
Yeah,
it's exactly. Like a foreign thing, right?
It's how real people live and not traveling bombs like we are.
Right, right.
Well, thank you so much, my dear. We really appreciate you doing this and joining us, and we'll be sure to have you on with us in a future. I would love to. Faust is on the docket.
Yeah.
Down there, and so we'll make sure to see if you can join us for that. Okay.
I would love that. I would love that. Right,
very much.
Love. Right. Great to see
you. For having me. Miss you guys.
Miss you too. We'll talk soon. Okay.
Bye.
Bye.
All right. So we have our third Gilda Kat is joining us now. You, while I bring her in, you tell us a little bit about Kat and how you guys have met, and then we'll let her do give her own.
Yeah, this is an interesting story. So Katrina and I met when she was an undergrad or master student at SMU?
I was an undergrad.
You were an undergrad at SMU, and yeah. I was a visiting guest artist faculty. They had a woman who retired, I guess, unexpectedly, and so they were looking for someone. It was one of the weirdest things to happen to me was that I went to go see the world premiere of Moby Dick at Dallas Opera, and some woman came up to me in the lobby and said, "You're Weston Hurt, aren't you?" And I said, "Yeah." And she goes, "You live here in Dallas?" And I was like, "Yeah, we live right just north." And she's like, "Would you be interested in teaching in SMU?" And I was like, "I mean, sure, yeah, I love teaching. I have a private studio, and I've taught in a couple other places, you know." She was, "Okay, great." And then it's time to go back in to see the rest of the show. The next week, on Monday, I got a call from Samuel Holland, and he was like, "Oh, I hear you're going to be joining us in the fall at SMU." And I was like, "Yeah, okay, cool." I'd never interviewed for that job. It was just like one of these random things that kind of fell in my lap. But I remember so clearly that Katrina was there as a student, and just an incredibly talented singer. And then I kept watching you just kind of rise through the ranks. You were a resident artist in Portland, yeah?
Yeah, it was in Portland and Arizona Opera as well.
Right. Yeah. Right. Did we ever do a show in Portland together?
No, we didn't. Okay, I know you were there, I think, before I started
being
a resident artist.
But yeah, but I mean, what an incredible, sort of career that you're making for yourself. It's you know, you've sung the role of Gilda, and what... I'm sure you've heard, hopefully, what we've been talking about with Iglesias and with Mary. You know, what's your take? I just want to know what your take on Caro Nome is. Is that the thing that you look forward to the most? Because I think, you know, I mean, if I compare, I haven't sung with you, but I've heard you sing. I would think that of the three singers, you would probably look forward to Caro Nome because you have that lighter, brighter, higher, crystalline kind of sound. Is that true? Do you agree with that? Or is it something that you're like, ah?
That's so funny that you asked, because I was thinking about it as I was listening to the other two, you know, Mary and Iglesias talk about it. And I thought, you know, I think it's just hard for everybody. I am a super high coloratura, you know, for me, Gilda is more on the lyric side of what I would sing.
Right.
And so you would think, oh, Caro Nome would be like the moment I'm waiting for. But by the time you get there, just like they said, like the pacing that it requires.
Right.
And just like they said, like the naked quality of the sound, it's like there's a lot of pressure in that moment to really, like, you have to be on top of your technique. You have to really have sung everything leading up to it pretty well, and also like have your wits about you to be able to just like focus in that moment and keep it all together. And for me, I had learned that aria when I was 19, I think.
Wow.
And so there were just like so many bad habits in it that had to be reworked, and so in a way it became the most challenging part of the whole opera when I did it.
Well, that makes sense. Having sung it like that with all the old habits, it's tricky how muscle memory plays such a role in learning a role, you know, because as a student sometimes we get these arias, you know, too early and we really weren't ready for it, and then however many years pass and then we're like, oh, I'm singing the whole thing in context now. And then you get to that point and it's like, what happened?
I mean, I would say even before the muscle memory, right? Like just in, you know, the flip side of the coin of listening to recordings, even before I've sung it, if I listen to like Luciano or anybody, quite frankly, I start subconsciously painting this picture of how I'm going to sing it by what vowel choices they're making. Mm. And then I have muscle memory without having even opened my mouth to sing it yet.
Right. You have this expectation of what it should be.
Right. So yeah, Kat, tell us about how you look at act three, right? So you come in, you know, you do the quartet where you're with dad outside. And then you dress up like the page boy and come in and sacrifice yourself. And then you get put in the bag, and then you have to sing this really delicate, beautiful thing lying on your side, kind of like, you know, tell us about the challenges of that after having, you know, sung the whole two acts before it.
Sure. You know, I think it's actually, it always felt pretty doable. The first act was always the hardest challenge, I thought. Then the second act is, you know, like the drama's ramping up. You have like these great moments of pathos that are just, for me, very rewarding to sing. And then the third act, it is like the drama. And what I love about it is like, I feel that Gilda does get to kind of have this moment where she shows her own agency. And that's how like I choose to look at it, because for me, it is hard to play her and to justify here in the third act. Like, you have to justify, why is she surrendering her own life for this guy who hasn't treated her very well?
Yeah.
And when I did it, it was like right around not too long after Me Too had just surfaced. And so we had a lot of conversations about it. And for me to play it, I had to like really feel like this was a decision that she was making for herself. Like, for her, in the time that she was living, for who she was, that was like a huge statement of her independence, so that it could be a strong choice, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So I think like for me, that's one of the more interesting things about Act Three. And then the music is incredible. And it's all about, from a technical perspective, for me, it's about like, how do I get into the middle voice and not, you know, push too much? Because the second that, you know, you start pushing through the middle, it actually, for me, you know, the sound gets quieter. And
yeah, for everybody, it just, yeah, like, yeah, you know, the more muscles that get in there, maybe for the first 5 minutes it'll sound like more exciting, but it just gets to get dull and duller and duller the more tired you get. I mean, I you know, I don't have to sing in the storm, but I know everybody who has to sing during the storm is like, no one can be heard over this thing.
Yeah, it's crazy. And like, it's kind of fun, because then when the top opens up, you're like, oh, I'm just gonna roar into this and scream into this, but you really can't do that either. Like, you're setting yourself up for a world of hurt.
Yeah. Exactly. And I mean, that's exactly what, you know, I think Robert Lyle was speaking about earlier. That's when you hear the four trombones really come in with this storm, and this, like, it's just,
yeah, the bop, 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 bop. Yeah, all that descending stuff. Oh my God.
Yeah.
So let's just say, yeah, we don't want to, you don't want to push that so that you're then like, you know, either too tired or just too thick to sing these beautiful La Suinchel. That is like the last, I mean, that's what everybody leaves the theater remembering. Those, yeah, beautiful, non parlamida, preghero, non mori. I mean, I'm getting goosebumps, and it's not even my part to sing. And I'm just like, ah.
Again, it's like, it's one of those moments from my perspective where it's like, I can't allow myself to go there emotionally. It's like, you have to walk this balance between having your daughter in your arms and begging her not to die. And this is the, oh, don't leave me alone. And hearing her beautiful, like, I'm going to go be with mother now, and da da da. Don't die. Oh, it's just like and then you have to, it just turns on a dime. Hey, Morta. You know, it's like, it's so, yeah, incredibly passionate. And then he has that idea. Ah, it was the curse. It was the curse, right, the whole time. And, you know.
Do you, Kat, do you, what's your thoughts and your relationship with Sutherland and her vocalism, and how you inform your vocalism by that or don't?
I love Joan Sutherland's voice and her singing, and I always have. And actually, I told Weston this before I got on the call. I'm so excited to talk about this because Joan Sutherland specifically, her recording of Caronome is one of the reasons I'm even a singer.
Wow.
When I was a freshman at SMU, I was actually a theater major, and I was, you know, just, it didn't feel quite right. I was unhappy. I was home over Christmas break and thinking, what am I going to do with my life? You know, like we all do from time to time. Sure. And I just thought, you know, well, I love singing. And so that was always a thought in the back of my mind. And I remember being in the car and listening to, you know, the classical station, and I heard Caronome, Joan Sutherland singing it. And I just thought, like, that's what I want to do. I want to sing that. And wow, it's kind of amazing. I didn't know really very much about classical music, so who even knew that I could be capable of that, or that was my voice type? But I felt like this connection, like, I need to sing that. And so I've always loved Joan Sutherland's voice. I've been told I have the Joan Sutherland jaw.
I can see the
cheekbone
and the whole thing. You know, I do think that there's part of the instinct and the ability to recognize, ah, that's something like me. I think I could do that. You know, and I think that when that happens, I think that you were really, you know, it's like a bolt of lightning, right? It's like, wow, okay, I think I could do this. Let me figure it out. Let me see. And it has led to this whole world of opera opening up for you in the career and singing this. So, you know, I will say
that as much as I want to sing the high C in Cajolita Manina, I can't do that. Yeah. I tried to do that.
We're going to have to relive that La Speranza challenge that we did over at your house, maybe video at this time.
Pat, do you know what we're talking about? The La Speranza challenge?
Oh yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So my attempt was pretty epic.
I didn't see yours. I'm going to go look for it now.
Oh my God.
Oh yeah. So, you know, how, coloraturas, I don't know. You tell me, do you guys have to do, other than Gilda, I can't think of a role where you have to like kind of sing laying down, which is its own trick, right? Mimi's have to do it a lot. Violetta's have to learn it for act three. But for me, those death scenes are written a little bit more easily, where you can sit up in the bed for certain moments in Traviata, and the same in this. I don't know how that works for this, I guess because I'm not on stage and I haven't watched a lot of people do it, but tell me a little bit about having to sing, you know, after you've been stabbed and in a bag and on the floor.
Yeah, actually that was always one of the most kind of, I guess, nervy parts, was like being in the bag, and I would feel like you're sitting in there, and I'd always be like, oh my gosh, my throat is so dry. Right. Am I gonna make it through? Like, why couldn't someone have hit a Ricola in here, you know? But you can't move while you're in there, you're dead or you're dying. So there's that.
How hard it is to sometimes be on stage and just wait for your time to start singing. And that's a real thing, right?
Yeah. Not to mention, who knows when the last time that bag was thoroughly cleaned. I've heard sopranos complain about the dust in the bag.
So that's the other part, is like you're getting like these little like fibers like sticking to your lips, and you're just like, it's gonna, it's almost done. But I mean, it's not so bad. And then you have this weird sensation of being carried blindly. You know, you feel your body being dragged across the stage, which is always a bizarre experience. And then I guess like singing in that position, you kind of work it out in rehearsal, you know, and you figure out, how can I be, you know, leaning against, you know, the Rigoletto's leg, or what can we do so that also like, so that you can see the conductor too. That's kind of the biggest thing. Yeah.
Well, so what do you say, guys? You want to listen to a little bit of this duet? Is there any?
Yeah. Well, let's listen to a little bit of the storm. Let's listen to a little bit of the storm scene where we hear that, those screaming voices. Well, of course, they can be produced and balanced with the recording, but I think it's great to hear the trombone stuff that you've been talking about, and then maybe the, you know, one of the last verses of the Rigoletto sings before the Lasso in Ciao.
Yeah. So let's see. You guys are going to have to help me here. It comes after.
I think Venti Scudi would be the one.
So. Mm-hmm. All right, so I've got Vent That's Up, and this is about a 5-minute track. So where do you want me to go?
Click there and see where we land.
Maybe like 2/3 of the way in.
Oh, maybe it's the next track?
Apparently it is.
Oh, there we go. Would you call that chest voice?
Questo uomo fedele m'avrà, il tuo che noia, canzoni perdiamo, lascia fare. Se poi è cambia in mezzo la notte, toccato al muro, poi giunga per esso morà.
That's just amazing.
Of course, yeah, I can't.
And how do you hold yourself back when you get to like finally sing that high note from not just like just screaming it out? It's really like that's the challenge, is like moderating it, especially with all the emotions too. You have the orchestra, you have the emotions the character's feeling, and then the way it's written just lends for you to want to just like really scream into it.
Yeah.
It's dangerous.
It's loud.
It's wow.
Without a doubt, yeah. So you guys want to hear any of La Suinchel or
yeah let's play the tail end of that. And of course, what's great, and let's play it all the way through to the end where I think I realized this in second year of graduate school. Somebody brought to my attention, oh, have you heard the Milnes at the end of this, you know, Rigoletto? He sings a high C flat in the cadenza, and I'm like, what? And yeah, he does. And he does it really well. He kind of does it surprisingly ridiculously well. But at this point, you know, I have to say, for whatever reason, the traditional, you know, thing to sing is to go up to the A flat. Ah, la maledizio. And then sometimes people lean on the A natural. Ah, right. What Verdi wrote was just, ah, la maledizio. He just wrote like D flats in there. And so whoever had the idea of taking it up to the A flat, kudos to you.
Well, I think it's cool, right? Because like it you know, that maledizione theme comes back. It's the first thing we hear in the right? And then it comes back when he sings it. And each time he sings it, it gets more and more dramatic and more like just nasty.
Haunting. It's finally come to life, to fruition with the death of his daughter. And, yeah. You know, I've never heard it like this. And it's just the C flat, the B natural, whatever you want to call it.
I heard Mark Rutger do that once in performance. And other than him, I don't think I've heard anybody else do it ever.
It's just unreal.
Yeah. All right. So here we go. I'm going to find where we want to go in here.
Incredible transition.
Non morir.
Tilda. Duh. I'm more.
Meant to start this with some quotes from Milnes's chapter with On Great Singers, Great Singing.
Yeah.
Because he clearly is someone who just is very cognizant of the choices he is making.
Super technical.
Technical. And he hits everything, like, just, you know, whether you agree with what he's saying or not, he hits all of it. I mean, so. I encourage anybody to go and read that. It's not that long. All these things are like 3 to 5 pages, but I mean, you don't have to wonder what, he's not doing anything by accident. And he, everything is absolutely an intelligent, calculated decision on how to best deliver that line. And, you know, he's still around. I don't know if we can get him on the show here.
Oh, we should.
But I'm definitely going
to send... My buddy, Lemmy Pulliam got him. They did an interview with him the other day.
We might be able to. I know his son, Sean, who does a lot of like online social media stuff. I'm probably going to send this to him and say, listen, we adore your dad. And
it's amazing.
We love him. And here's this link. If you think it's something he would appreciate to see, great. If you want to watch it and just say, no, sorry.
Yeah.
but yeah, I mean, I remember hearing that and being like, I've never heard a baritone sing that high. Are you kidding me?
We need to do the A la Meditazione challenge.
I mean, and he does say, right, about the excitement. I mean, okay, clearly he was, you know, he kind of hooks in.
Call
it the hook, or which has kind of got a bad connotation. I mean, he does hook into a note in the way that it's super supported, and it's kind of like a, I think he even says in the Great Singers Aren't Great Singing, it's like a he. It's like that thing where you go and you start the sound, but then you like kind of bounce on the support.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. He goes on to talk about, he goes, it sounds exciting. And he says the audience needs to know that this is something hard to do, even though it's not. He goes, they need to think it's hard.
And just like Mary was saying, is that we're not living in a time where it's all about, like, I mean, technical things are for us, right? And if you want to appreciate the technical prowess of a certain singer, that's great. But really what the audience and the average audience goer wants to come to the opera to be moved, to hear exciting, passionate, emotional singing. And I think it's very shrewd of him to be able to recognize the difference when, you know, you do something like that and the audience just goes crazy. I mean,
oh yeah.
You know, sometimes I was working with a conductor and I was doing Louisa Miller aria. In concert, it usually ends up, right? Mi tradia, ai me. But in the score, it's mi tradia. Great in the show, in the middle of it, the scene goes on, there's more to say. In a concert, you're left a little bit like, oh, is that how it ends? Huh. So we had a different conductor for the last show. I asked him if I could do it. And he was like, oh yeah, this is a concert, whatever. And I went, hi, May, and held it like as long as I could. And then people were like, wah!
Right.
Because they just know, ooh, that's an exciting high note and he's holding it long and that's impressive.
Yeah.
Most people are not gonna sit there with their intellectual musicologist hat on and be like, oh, well, that was very in poor taste to end with that high note like that. You know what I mean? It's like,
you make reference to the script, you will notice that.
We have to walk the balance of giving the people what they want while still respecting the artistic integrity of the music and the composer and all those things, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
True story.
I was gonna
jumping off of that, like, I will say, I think almost that last scene, like Joan Sutherland sings it so perfectly. It's almost like hard to believe that she's dying at moments. Right. That would be like my one thing that I think every time I listen to her, you know, and then at the very last word, you know, she kind of does that little, okay, we know she's dying, but I mean, come on, Joan. I'm just kidding. It's who am I to say that?
I mean no sacrilege by this at all, but I mean, I grew up and went to Catholic school my whole life. And there's that line that, you know, that is on earth as it is in heaven, right? And that's what I think of studio recordings, right? Sure, if on earth, as it would be like at the highest level of perfection with never sound, never a tired notes, never a flat note, never a whatever, you know? And I think that it's wonderful to have those things. It's also helpful to just keep in mind, that's why when we move to like live recordings to hear what's different. Oh, I hear them getting a little bit tight or a little bit tired. How are they going to handle that? Because there's still 10 minutes of the scene left to go. But you know,
or if you listen to the Merrill recording from the Metropolitan Opera that's live from the Met, you can hear the prompter giving him every word, every word, and he's still. Sometimes just leave out entire chunks. It's unbelievable.
Hey man, that's the magic of live theater, right?
That's right. That's right.
Yes.
Well, Kat, thank you so much. It's lovely to meet you. I've never met you before tonight, but thanks so much for being a part of it. And I hope that that you had fun and that you'll come and join us on some other shows that we do down the future. Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me, and nice meeting you too. Good seeing you again, Weston.
Great to see you.
All right, well, we are running like just over 2 hours, which is way longer than I planned for this to go. But what can you say? When the ball gets rolling and good stuff.
When the tenor starts talking.
Yeah, we have two more callers here.
Oh.
And so I'm going to go with Opera Joe McKesson.
Joe McKesson.
A good friend of ours. You know him from IU. I know him from being here in New Orleans.
Yeah.
And I'm going to bring him in now. He's been listening, and I pitched this idea to him yesterday over lunch, and I think he got really excited about it. And I hope that I look forward to hearing what he thought. So let's bring Joe in here. Joining, it says he's joining.
Yeah, that's the thing about these the Zoom calls. You know, it takes a second, and then we got to get the audio connected. And
he is. There's our buddy Joe.
Hello. What a wonderful show it's been. This has been amazing.
I love the beard, Joe. The beard is so nice and thick.
I know. Well, you know, it's Christmas, you know, so, and I've been a Santa my whole life. So maybe I'll just go all the way this year and just never come back.
I could scarcely think of a better Santa, Joe. I mean, yes, the beard gets you a long way, the hair as well, but your jolly spirits, I mean, listen, I don't know, for anybody who doesn't know Joe, he is a tenor. He studied at Indiana University. I think that's where Weston and Joe first met there.
And Jeff Monette, I went
to. That's right.
Oh, how fun.
That's right.
And so Joe and I connected when he was working down here in New Orleans a couple years ago, and he's been really a saving grace for our Opus Opera, which is our nonprofit opera thing down here. And he's just a jack of all trades, a true Renaissance man who is the most technically savvy person I think I know, but savage as well.
Totally.
Obviously a singer and an opera lover and someone who is just, you know, his heart is in the right place and, you know, for he's done much more work for us than we've been able to pay him to do, but we love him and we appreciate it. And we look forward to hearing what you think about this, and tell us, you know, ask us your questions. Tell us what you liked, what you thought was, could have been better. Maybe we went too long. I know this is kind of on the long side, but I just got carried away a little bit.
Well, with opera, that's bound to happen. You know, that when I had an opera show for about a couple of years called Garage Opera, and I would play all the old recordings because nobody plays the old recordings, right?
Wow.
So I play all the old recordings and talk about them and get guests on when I could. I got a Prelé Milo on once, which was really fun.
Oh, yeah.
But sometimes, you know, if the opera is 5 hours long, the show is going to be 5 hours long in some cases. I would just go on forever. And because you want to comment. And I love the comments you guys are doing. I think it gives people a lot of insight into how truly technical and difficult this can be from the performer point of view. Yeah. You know, you've got so many things to worry about, you know, and everyone else is just out sitting in their seats having a good time, hopefully, you know. And, you know, that's why I love recording so much, because you, as you were saying earlier, Brian, how they're kind of like, you know, that, you know, the best of all possible worlds, you know, in a recording, you know, you can stop and you can fix things, you know, you can rest, you can take a couple days between acts, you know. But this recording that you guys have chosen to me has always been the benchmark. You know, Pavarotti recorded it, the opera, four times with a huge different variety of people. But this recording, in terms of the singer's equality and talent, gifts, nuance, and musicality, is perfection. I've never met anyone who thinks differently.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, we have a list, you know, of things that we're going to start with, you know, and we're going to try and do one of these every week. And this literally was just the one that between the two, you know, of all the ones that Weston and I listed, this was so high on the list because it's a role that he has sung a lot.
I saw him. He was amazing here in New Orleans.
Yeah, he was amazing here in New Orleans. We saw him, cheered and loved it. And we're singer driven in the sense that, you know, with the singers that we admire would be Merrill, would be Warren, would be Björling, Corelli,
Milnes,
Marotti, Sutherland, Caballé, Milnes, Marilyn Horne. And we're technically, we're going to stick to singers that, you know, again, are not singing anymore. Mainly because we just, these are the people who were singing when we started singing.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll move to later ones and we'll do live ones and compare the differences and this kind of stuff. But I just thought that it was really, it would be interesting for listeners to understand a bit about the recording process and how, you know, if you hear Pavarotti's voice is so vibrant, you know, that's the idea, the acoustical idea that the engineer and the producer had, and that's the way they mixed it. Milnes is, you know, he had an idea of how Milnes sound, of how Sutherland sound. And so it's not, let's just make them sound as good as possible. Most producers' integrity are like, let me paint through these microphones and through my ability to mix the sound, the most realistic picture of what they sound like.
Totally. And you really hear it in that storm scene, right? It's like every single isolated part is perfectly pitched to its mic. There's no overflow. There's no cacophony between the cracks, between the horns and the chorus and the singers themselves. Everything is just perfect. Of course, they recorded so much differently then too. Remember, they had taped out boxes on the stage in a huge room, you know, and they would move around. Now everybody's, you know, contained in a recording chamber, sometimes with the orchestra, sometimes not, you know, so it's kind of a different world in many ways, you know. But I love what you guys are pointing out for that, because I think, you know, part of the thing about opera is that it's always going to be mouth to mouth. It's always going to be an eclectic taste that we wish would blow up, but doesn't necessarily do so, because we're also, you know, we're all so ensconced in the life itself. Even I'm not a singer anymore, but my empathy for singers, watching their careers, watching young singers try things, watching you guys, you know, come up and succeed, you know, it's very trying for me. But part of that connection is to the new audience, and in the digital age, I think you guys have a great idea there.
Well, thank you. You touched on earlier, maybe Weston, you can take this one over for me. I mean, opera is such, it's like an onion, right? There's so many levels. You got the very base level, which is just beautiful music, beautiful singing. Then you've got the librettos are like Shakespearean level poetry. It's just not in a language that we understand first.
Yeah.
Right. So tell us about the other levels of that onion for you.
Well, I mean, for me, I mean, I think you nailed it. It's like you have to start, or at least I start, with the text and trying to understand and comprehend, like, how do you translate, not just from Italian to English or German to English or whatever it might be, but like, how do you make sense of that, you know, in like your colloquial vernacular in 2020? You know, how do you make sense emotionally of that so that you can sort of put yourself, and I talk to my students about this all the time. It's like, you've got to be able to tell a story that excites you. And you know, ideally it would be in the same exact, you know, sort of mood and color of whatever it is that the piece is in, sure. But we've got to find a way to connect to this so that when we tell the story, it's not like we're just singing it again for the 500 millionth time of this piece that's been around for the last 200 years,
right.
But it's got to be fresh and unique and come to life in that way. But, you know, once we're able to sort of make that connection, we have to, you know, I think Katrina, or I can't remember who, Mary mentioned getting it into their body, you know, getting the role into the body, physicalizing the piece.
Right.
And I think that is a unique, you know, thing for each individual artist. You know, I mean, for me, it's been interesting because, you know, I remember well, when I first got started in this career, you know, I was born without my right hand. And I remember specifically singing for companies right out of Juilliard that told me point blank, we'd love to hire you as long as you have a prosthesis. And I remember thinking to myself, I'm like, so you love what I'm singing. You love how I'm doing this, but like physically, you want me to look a different way than I look. You want me to have two hands in order to be cast in this role. And so that for the first time in my life really became like, wow, this art form is not only oral, right? But it's also physical. And of course, the gag would be that I'd get to the gig. Once I got the prosthesis, I'd arrive to the gig and the director would say, what would you think about singing this role without your prosthesis? You know, and of course I was like, yeah, I was born without my hand. This would be great. And I remember the first time that happened was I was singing the role of Sharpless in Butterfly. And we were putting together production, and you know, I had an opportunity to work with Frank Cazzaro at Juilliard, and he really loved the role of Sharpless. In fact, in his book Maverick that he wrote, there's a whole conversation that he has with Dominic Cosa where they talk about the intricate details of this character of Sharpless. And you think, I mean, I've heard him also referred to as pointless, but I think in the show, if you think like, well, why does he have the desk job? You know, what did he miss? And so we made this whole backstory. I lost my hand in war. That's what put me into this sort of, you know, position at the consulate. Because of that, you know, it drove me to drink and I became an alcoholic. And so in the whole, you know, the whole stuff between you and I in Act One, you know, it's like, I can't wait. I see that the bourbon is right there waiting for me. And you're like, oh, do you want to drink? I'm like, yeah, I want to drink, you know? And I think that we played, you know, we were able to create this. A very major publication was there at that performance and the review came out. Weston Hurt, despite his own physical limitation, was still able to sing the role of Sharpless with beautiful lyricism and, you know, and I just thought, oh my God, like, yeah.
May I?
You may.
I now remember that story. I didn't know that's where you're going with this because it was so beautiful, everything that you were coming and talking about, the layers of the onion and everything else.
Yeah.
But also what you were talking about how do we bring something up to make it more accessible to the younger generation. Lots of people try to dumb this down, dumb opera down, or try to, like, you know, make the libretto, like, you know, more in the parlance of our times, to quote the dude from Lebowski.
Right.
Should we not rather invite the audience members to lift themselves up to a standard of what, of artistic, like, appreciation and beauty? And, like, you don't have, I mean, Shakespeare is incredibly amazing and wonderful. But if you don't get to know how he tells a story and start to understand the meter of the poetry and such, well, that's just lost. Well, right. Should we change Shakespeare to make sense to young people? Or should we say, hey, you know what? This is worth getting to know and understanding, because once you do, there's this whole treasure trove of characters and plays that will make your life richer if you put in a little bit of time, sure, to get over the hurdle of what separates us from now and the hundreds of years ago when these things were written in the way that they spoke. I mean, sure. And if that's a critic, if that's someone who had a job to critique classical music and art and opera, and they say something so I don't even, the words that are coming to my mind, I can't say on this program right now.
The reason I bring that up is because it's all part of this onion that you're talking about, because as we dive into these characters, we also have to keep into consideration what we bring to it as the artist, right? Yeah. Because as we interpret this, we have to then portray it on stage. And like we say, it's this one art form that combines all of the arts with it. We, you know, that Tito Capobianco, insatiable sensuality.
Yeah.
And so I think it's important. And the reason I even mentioned it for this Rigoletto is because that was one of the first roles that I sang where I was like, you know what? I'm not going to wear my prosthesis. You know, if there's one character who has the hunchback or is deformed or whatever, I can feel completely free to play this role without wearing a prosthesis and without apologizing for it.
Right.
And for me, that allowed me to get into the character in a different way and interpret this text and interpret, you know, and break down those layers of that onion in a way that really started to hit home.
And what you just said there, right? Like about how, yes, part of our process is to present this show to the audience, but part of it is also for us to be fulfilled as artists and singers and actors to tell these stories. And that makes us think, like you said earlier about Millie and when you were singing that after, you know, when she was on the way, like it's so rich for us. You know, musicians are really good about checking our prejudice at the door when we come in to rehearsals. Yeah. And I think most musicians check their prejudice. They kind of whitewash it out anyway, because we realize that those are silly constructs that just make people think in the us against them mindset, right? Which that's a political conversation for a whole nother thing. But the point being is that music for the musicians and the artists who are making it is all about, you know, appreciating somebody's talent, somebody's ability to do this. You know, there are times when you're making music with other people where Rigoletto is the main character and we're all listening or supporting, or the Duke is, or Gilda. You know, these are like skills about, like, you know, that are great to learn for anything in life, in business, in whatever, in just how to be a better human. Like, you don't have to be in the spotlight the whole time. You can share it and you can do all this kind of stuff. And I just think, again, not to go off on a tangent, but the more that people can understand what we have learned from our art form, if they can start to get and glean that from an operatic performance, well, that's as relevant to today's audience as it's ever been.
Sure.
You know, parents trying to protect their children from the horrors of the world, and the exchange. I mean, if you do yourself a favor and read the libretto, not the synopsis, but the libretto before you go to the opera, let's say you probably spent 20 to 100 or more on a ticket. Invest the 30 minutes it might take you to read the libretto and be like, wow, that is really beautiful stuff. If you don't know the music, I wonder how the composer is going to set this. Mm-hmm. And if you're lucky enough to do Rigoletto or Tosca or Bohème or any of these other like masterpieces, you won't be disappointed. But this idea that you're going to go to the opera like you're going to a movie, that's not what this is about. You know, you can't just go and sit there and be like, oh, let me see what's going to happen between Mimi and Rodolfo. It's not that kind of thing. It's not in your language. It's an art. You know, there are some art films, but they're just the fact that there's the term art film and independent film implies that blockbusters and movies are a completely different thing.
Yeah.
You know, and so, yeah.
Well, the change through time, right? I mean, I love what you're saying, Brian, because it really excites me as an opera goer. I listen to probably 3 or 4 operas a week, every week. You know, and there's so much available online. And I do that because I know that there's an exchange that happens between a great artist and an audience that's there to be attentive. When these two things come together and people are rooting for the artist and the artist is rooting for the audience by giving them everything they have, you know, which is a tremendous balance of energy and pacing and water and nose blowing and all kinds of crazy human things that people never imagine go on because they get enthralled in the drama, you know, but this is our history, our legacy. It's like, you know, it's like, are you going to watch NCIS or go to the opera? They're going to tell you similar things, but one is going to be much more beautiful, you know, even if you have a crush on one of the characters.
And you know, the good thing is that with with everything streaming right now and on demand, you can go to the opera and when it's healthy and safe to do so, and sit in that room and hear an acoustical experience, a snapshot of music that will start and then will finish and will never happen again. Right. I mean, that is something that you can't, you can stream this over and over again.
Yeah,
CSI is just made there to be like, you know what? I got some time to kill. Let me go see this.
It's pornography.
That being said, you know, if anybody tries to argue the fact that the youth of today doesn't have the attention span to sit through an opera, I say complete bullshit, because you see them watching episode after episode after they will binge watch an entire season of something without getting off their bed. Mm-hmm. They can focus on something. And I say, might as well bring them up to the level of an art form that would be life-changing.
Yeah, I agree. Listen, guys, we're at 2:30. We got one more caller. Joe, thank you so much for
this. Thank you.
We will hope to hear from you and invite you to talk and give us your thoughts.
Well, I wish you all great luck.
Thanks so much, Joe. So much love, and we'll talk to you soon. So I've got Zach here. Zach is a buddy of mine who reached out to me about some lessons, and he has a beautiful, there he is. Hey, bud, how you doing?
I think you're on mute, my man.
No worries.
My bad.
There you go.
So Zach has a really top-notch, world-class tenor voice, he just wrote to me on Facebook, and you know, I'm pretty open. So I just, he only said nice things. Otherwise I'm going to delete you.
You mentioned him when I was there in New Orleans hanging out with you.
And I think I played his clip. Yeah,
for you, right? And I think Zach, you and I are friends on Facebook, but it's nice to find meet you in person. And Brian's right. You got a fantastic instrument, fantastic voice. So have you sung the Duke?
No, I have not. I'll tell you, like, I love listening, and I'm sure this is the case for all the younger singers or the up and coming singers who are going to be listening to you guys. It's so, you know, we have a lot of the opera podcasts right now where we get to meet the personality of the opera singers that we listen to. And then we've got your amazing podcast where we get to hear about technique, which to me, that's, you know, what I really love. But I think this is cool because we can like see how you guys are feeling in these, when you're on the stage singing these amazing roles. And that's something I've never gotten to kind of pull the curtain back on. And, you know, you seem almost, like giants in our eyes doing these things. And it's nice to hear those lovely ladies saying that, you know, they're about to die out there or whatever. it's really going to be helpful for a lot of people, I think, to hear this.
I'm glad to hear you say that.
Actually, I'm glad you said that, because it made me think, I was trying to think a little tagline, right, to just kind of make this catchy. And we were, you know, I don't even know if I remember to ask Weston, but it's kind of like behind the scenes, behind the mic, or behind the mic, behind the scenes.
Yeah.
Behind the music, because it is really like, you know, part of the idea of this was to demystify what opera is and recordings in general and what we do on the stage, not to take away from the greats or even what we're doing, but to just show exactly like Joe was saying, all the aspects and how you have to be an incredible multitasker, and all the things that people don't usually think about, like, how long are you going to be inside this dusty canvas bag before you have to sing the most beautiful high notes of the night? And I hope that, I mean, it's interesting to us, but it's also our life, right? I hope that it's interesting to other people and that they want to listen and hear more war stories and kind of, like I said, hear how this came out. I mean, Weston, his mom, and they're both choir directors, so musicians
is my stepdad. Yeah.
I never went to an opera before I was 18. Like, the music that I grew up on was country western, Neil Diamond, stuff like that. If I can love opera, anybody can love opera, you know, and cultures in Africa and the Far East and the Middle East. So places where it's not part of their own cultural heritage and story also this resonates with them, this music, and they start to love it too. And so there's something bigger than all of us in this art form of opera. And I just think we gotta get people to open up the window before they can open the door, before they can walk into the theater with confidence and watch 3 hours in a foreign language at tickets that cost $150. I mean, that's hurdle after hurdle to have to go. But I mean, we either try and do it and get people back into the theater, or we pack it up and say, I'm so glad we have these lovely recordings. You know what I mean?
I don't think that's an option. I think
yeah, let's wait a little bit on that, please.
Yeah, I hope so, buddy. Trust me, I hope so. But if I gotta start flipping houses next year, that's what I'm gonna do.
I so think Zach, everybody's sort of found a passion in this time of figuring out what else you can do and what else you can do well.
There's not a singer that I know that doesn't have they're not working on a plan B right now in case this goes
three years. Yeah, sorry to cut you off. You know, it's interesting, you know, when we approach, let's say, a Bachelor of Music and Vocal Performance, oftentimes parents will say, like, well, are you sure about that? I think you need to have a plan B or a fallback or a, right. And then there's this whole argument about, well, if you have a fallback, then you're not going to really pursue it with all your, you know, energies, because you're always going to think you have a fallback. Well, the thing that I think is really important for young singers to remind themselves of is that if you happen to not be one of the 0.000001 people who come out of graduate school and fall into this pipeline of like excellent young artist program, excellent apprentice program, finding the right manager, and then off you go on your way, having a correlating career while you're still pursuing music is in no means a failure as a singer or as an artist. And I think that now in this moment, it proves stronger than ever that I sure hope that you have other passions and other abilities and other things to do, because, you know, you say plan B, and I'm not suggesting that that's not, I mean, I think that's how most people think of it, but it really is this idea of like finding ways to balance your life so that singing is still part of it. And I think oftentimes singers just think of it as like, I have failed if I have to do anything else.
Sure. I mean, I remember there was a coach when I was studying in Italy, and I remember she said, there are no 30-year-old opera singers. There are people who are in their 30s who can sing, but at 30, you haven't lived your life enough to have the perspective to portray these characters that are going through these kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And it seemed misleading, and I was like, this is bullshit. But then now I understand what she means. At 40 or 41, like after you've had, you know, Millie, now you can pour things into Rigoletto that you couldn't do before. And I know Absolutely. When I did Troyen, there's this whole point where he sings, you know, I'm about to his son, I'm about to go off to war, and I may not come back. So these people are going to teach you how to essentially become a man, become a fighter, right. a warrior.
Right.
And after I had my kids, although I don't have boys and they're not going off to war.
Oh, I was just like, the idea of being a parent. Yeah. Like,
and now now I actually have to try not to think about that before I start singing, or I'm gonna be cracking all these B-flat, you know, stuff. But anyway, listen, Zach, tell us what are your thoughts? Do you have any questions? Do you have anything to add?
There's not a lot to add, because it was a really thorough program and really great. I was thinking about the live recording from 72 that is on YouTube with the same cast, and
really,
it's just really, yeah. Yeah, I found it on YouTube recently, and it's really awesome. It's
now I feel like it's done my homework a little bit better before this. Thanks for showing me up, buddy.
Mm-hmm. Well, that'll be the only time I get to do that. But it's really interesting, and you know, I spend a ton of time thinking about like the acoustics of the voice, and I think all singers do, but. Pavarotti and Sutherland seem to like in the studio recording, they seem to sing it basically the same as the live recording. Their technique seems almost exactly the same, but Milnes almost makes a different acoustic choice in the studio recording. You know, you were talking about the Quel Vecchio,
yeah,
example in the beginning. The difference between how he sings that in the studio recording versus the live recording is so interesting, because it's almost kind of off the voice a little, you know, it's more.
Wait, okay, I just pulled it up. Hold on. I just pulled it up. Let me
20 minutes.
You want me to screen? I'm going to make you the host, right?
Yeah, make me the host. Let me share the screen. And let me, because
Did it do it?
Give me a second. I'm getting there. I'm still learning all these things. It's my first episode, okay? You've been doing this for months now. I am just getting into this.
I hear you. Okay, so you said it's 20 minutes in?
I think it's about 20, right at 20 minutes.
Oh, wait, that's Partisiamo, so it's going to be before that.
Oh, yeah.
Here we go. So this is the same clip that we listened to earlier. There were some similarities there.
Sure. It just seemed a little more.
He's a little more on the breath, a little more on the body, you know, just to get out.
I mean, go ahead, Zach, go ahead. You first.
Well, I was just going to say, I think it's just brilliant that like you get to see these two sides of this artist. Like, I mean, it's a little more, you know, I think he could sing a little more precious if that's not a bad word to use in this situation in the live or in the studio recording. And you get to see even more acting and it's more intimate, you know, and then to just see how he has to work a little differently to carry in the house is pretty cool.
For sure. And that's just him by himself, right? Like you can hear the size of that voice on the stage. Sure. And when he starts that soft and it opens it up, I mean, I forget who was saying, maybe it was Susan Graham or somebody had posted on Facebook, like there is nothing more impressive than a big voice singing softly, right? Yeah. And you hear him start from there, but yet supported, like, which I agree with you. And I could tell you from being in the studio and dealing with producers and record company people, because there is no visual aspect, they want to overdo the colors and that mm-hmm. exact stuff that you're talking about. And that's, you know, that's again, that's part of the subjective side of what one looks for. I think as a singer, I would rather hear somebody sing it the way that they would on stage, but that's just me. I'm only one person buying the CD, whereas most of the people who are buying the CDs are audience members. They're not singers.
Well, you know, one artist that sings today that comes to mind that really exhibits this exact thing that we're talking about is Bryn Terfel.
Yeah.
In Bryn Terfel's recordings, I mean, it's like he's got the mic right here and it's like the mm-hmm. most, to use your word, precious, you know, it's so, I'm like, how would that even carry past like, you know, 3 feet but then if you hear him live, it's like, oh
yeah,
that dude's got a horn, you know, I mean, he can really sing on the breath when he needs to and wants to or whatever. So
sure. I mean, the producer for my first CD, the French CD, was the same producer of some of Bryn's stuff. I think he did the Vagabond CD, which is
talk about CDs that I grew up with. That wore that thing out.
And he was the one that would come over the God mic and be like, can't you find like a more, you don't have to sing for the hall. Cause we did that one again in a big hall too, mm-hmm. At which I had sung concerts. So when you're standing on the stage and you're looking at like 1200, 1500 seats, your instinct, and it's rightly so, is to go, bah, here's my sound. But in that, you had to pretend, I mean, the mic is as close as this one is to me now. We're talking 6 inches a foot. And they, you know, it's a preference. And I'm sure maybe conductors often want that kind of stuff to hear more. And again, I think that you can justify it in saying that you only have the sound to rely on to tell that story. You don't have the facial expression. You don't have the body language.
Yeah.
So, I mean, fine. It's a different medium if that's what people want to do.
Great.
Totally. What do you think, Weston? By the way, do you want to jump to the end and see if he's...
Oh, yeah.
He does.
Okay, hold on. Does. Let's see.
He does.
And it's great.
Let's see. Let me share the screen one more
time. Maybe better.
All right. So this is the very last little bit here. Oh wait, no. This is not, there must be a part two.
There must be a part two. Maybe go to that same guy, the same, like the person who posted this and see.
It's got their, yeah, it's that one with the three in color, the pictures in color.
This here.
Right? Yeah, oh, yeah. And it's right at the end. Yeah.
Here we go. I mean, give me a break, dude.
You hear that when he goes, better than the studio recording, actually.
That's better. That's better.
It is.
Longer, it's
when,
like,
well, when he sings that, Lola Charmina, like, it's just God. And then to have, so you hear him sing, ah, la maledizia. That's so open and so open. Like, how does he even? I don't even know how he makes that transition. That's unbelievable.
Well, maybe we can get him on here.
Yeah, we got to get him on here and talk to him about one last thing. That idea to do it.
Yeah.
You know, I would love to talk to him about that.
I mean, I think he's the first one to sing that version with the C flat in it. Quite
yeah,
I don't remember anybody before him to do that. Yes, the A flat or the A natural even, but.
Yeah, yeah.
One thing I will say that I have heard, and I haven't necessarily experienced this, but I do understand and could see how it works. There are certain voices that don't capture, it's like a photogenic voice, they call it, right? And Milnes and Placido, for instance, you know, when Domingo, when I've heard, I mean, I grew up listening to his recordings, and one of the first things I ever did was Romeo and Juliet with him. And I was like, okay. And, you know, people would say, even my first teacher would say, well, he sounds like he's working a little bit harder than he should, right? And I was like, okay, I hear that. It gets tight, you know, whatever. He was baritone, became a tenor. Now he's baritone again, whatevs. I'd pay to see him on stage. And I've been able to sing with him on stage. And I could barely contain myself as, like, he was singing, you know, Di Provenza. I'm just like,
you did Traviata with him?
I did in Paris. Yeah. I'm like, I can't even stand here. Like with you looking at me and holding me on the shoulders and then like putting your head on my shoulder. I'm like, I got to pinch myself. Like this shit is not real. Right.
That's unbelievable.
But like, so I remember when I heard him again, that story, when I heard him at the Met the first time, I was like, he doesn't sound anything like he sounds on the recordings. It's much rounder and much, not really darker, but just more velvety. People say the same thing of Tucker. You know, Tucker can be nasal in recordings, quite frankly. I forget where I read it, but somebody said, you know, recordings don't do your voice justice, Richard, because it's so much more beautiful and colorful than what the mics are able to capture. And, you know, that could be just a situation with Cheryl Milnes on this, too. Because when you do the live recording, I mean, it's the mic is like, you know, 30, 40 feet away. I mean, I assume that they're just using the page, the monitor system, and tapping into that. But you hear the voice bloom in the hall in a way that's much warmer and less like hollow. I think that's what you were talking about, Zach, when you're talking about how it becomes like so covered in cupo, like it's like, we lose the core, but you don't lose the core.
Not in the live,
No.
Thanks for that first for bringing that to our attention. I love that.
Yeah. That was my first. The first thing I noticed with the live recording was just how present and how just bigger than everything in the room that voice was. You know, and it's really incredible. Yeah.
Well, buddy, thank you for staying on. I know we're kind of running late here, but I just wanted to thank you for that. And thank you again for, yeah, for bringing that to our attention. I'm going to do my homework next time a little bit better. But I think it's been great. And thank you for that. And we'll talk soon, okay?
Thanks for having me, guys.
Yeah, it's great to meet you. Take care.
Well, bud, I think that was a pretty successful first show. I mean, I enjoy talking to you for almost 3 hours, but we get to do that a couple times a week.
That's just true. I just hope that, I hope people were able to hang in there with us.
Yeah, I do too. And I will maybe put out the caveat that this is a little bit longer than our normal ones will go, but we had a lot to cover in our first episode and we wanted to include.
We're learning as we go.
Yeah, three different Gildas all having sung at different places in their career in different houses. I mean, You know, thank you for bringing in those people and Jeff, of course. And so
that was great.
Let's sign off and say thanks for everything. And
until next time.
And until next
time. I feel like we need a theme song eventually where it needs to be like, you get your trumpet play a little bit.
Right. Again, the car talk thing and like click and clack. I mean, the idea, though, the banter between those two brothers and them, like, you know, being like totally casual and then some caller calling in with a random noise. Like, this is the noise.
Right.
I know what that is.
It's like, sounds like you're probably driving down the snow and your wheel fell off and you tried to replace, you know.
And it's like, these guys exactly know what the hell they're talking about. They sound like everyday guys, but they got their shit together.
Well, how many times have you met somebody that didn't already know you were a singer and then they find you're an opera singer? You seem like a normal, you know, it's like, I think we kind of possess that similar quality of normal guys, Texas, Louisiana.
Absolutely. I think we are normal guys. And I think that if anything, us being ambassadors for this art form that's given us so much is the least we could do.
Absolutely.
For the art form. And so, well, listen, buddy, have a good rest of your week. And I look forward to next week. We're going to decide probably today or tomorrow what we're going to do next week. And we will let you guys know. Okay.
Thanks for being here.
All right. Talk soon, bud.
All right.